So are we live? That's all I need to know. We are live, episode number 50 with our friend Byron Udell here. My man, 50th episode. Byron is back.
That's a big number, 50.
Byron, last time you were on, people loved you. Okay. Now, I don't know if it was the looks because you used to be a model before. I don't know if it's the brains because you're brilliant. I don't know if it's because you're very good at debating and you enjoy it. I don't know if it's because you're mathematics. I don't know why, but people loved you, and it's good to have you back.
Thanks.
Back by popular demand, Byron Udell.
Yeah, and by the way, if you're listening to this, usually when we do the podcast, we go through the notes, right? We'll get together and we'll go through the notes. And yesterday, every single point, I'm just trying to get to the point. He's not letting me.
No.
What do you think about this? How can this even be possible? I said, Byron, today's not the podcast. It's tomorrow.
He thought he was on the
podcast.
I want to
talk about it right now. We got to talk about this right now. So then we go to dinner last night.
Oh, dinner was ridiculous.
If there was a camera at the the life insurance industry would have enjoyed it if you would have listened to it. Because, you got a self-made guy here, Adam, who's done a great job with life settlement, which Byron's a big fan of it.
Yeah.
You got a Byron Udell, who's built a company called AccuQuote, a good $50 million company that you run out of Chicago, based in Chicago. He's raised incredible kids. I mean, there's a lot of things we can talk about. I'm going to stop bragging because I'm done with my limitation. I told you, my compliments are done. I'm done with you as well with my compliments. So tell us, how you doing?
Doing great.
Yeah?
Oh, except for my torn MCL, but other than that, yeah.
Okay, torn MCL. Yeah. That's what happens when you go down the hill 73 miles an hour at 59 years old. It's skiing.
It's what happens.
Yeah.
This is what happens when you have multiple places in Aspen and you're skiing. You're going to get a knee injury.
It's great to have an extremely strong conservative in the house, right? Can I read you guys something crazy before we get started with today's podcast?
Of course.
So my dad sends me this email. Every once in a while, I get a weird email from my dad.
Have you ever met his dad, by the
way? Absolutely.
Yeah. My favorite guy.
Yeah.
Love that
guy. So I get this email yesterday, and it's about Walmart versus morons. Have you read this or no?
No.
Okay, so dad, if you're listening to this, this is a shout out to you. So he sends me this email. I said, I got to read this on the podcast this Thursday. So Walmart versus the morons, right? Americans spend $36 million at Walmart every hour of the day. $36 million every hour. This works out to be $20,928 profit every minute. Walmart will sell more from January 1st to St. Patrick's Day, March 17th, than Target sells all year long. Walmart is bigger than Home Depot, Kroger, Target, Sears, Costco, Kmart combined. Walmart employs 1.6 million people in the U.S., largest employer in the world. Walmart is the largest company in the history of the world. Walmart now sells more food than Kroger, Safeway combined, and keep in mind that they did this only in 15 years. During the same period, 31 big supermarket chains sought bankruptcy. Walmart now sells more food than any other store in the world. Walmart has approximately 3,900 stores in the U.S., of which 1906 are supercenters. This is 1,000 more than it had 5 years ago. This year, 7.2 billion different purchasing experiences will occur at Walmart stores. Earth's population, roughly 7 billion. 90% of all Americans live within 15 miles of Walmart. You may think that I'm complaining, but I'm really laying the groundwork for suggesting that maybe we should hire the guys who run Walmart to fix the economy. This should be good. This should be read and understood by all Americans, Democrats, Republicans, and everyone. President Biden and all 535 voting members of the legislature, it is now official that the majority of you are morons. Now, whoever wrote this article, this is not me writing it. I'm reading it, right? The U.S. Postal Service was established in 1775. You have had 246 years to get it right, and it is still broken. Social Security was established in 1935. You've had 86 years to get it right, and it's still broke. Fannie Mae was established in 1938. You've had 71 years to get it right, and it's still broke. War on Poverty started in 1964. You've had 57 years to get it right. $1 trillion of our money is confiscated each year and transferred to the poor, and they only want more. Medicare and Medicaid were established in 1965. You have had 56 years to get it right, and they are broke. Freddie Mac was established in 1970. You've had 51 years to get it right, and it is broke. The Department of Energy was created in 1977 to lessen our dependence on foreign oil. It has ballooned to 16,000 employees, a budget of $24 billion a year, and a very important, more oil than ever before. You've had 44 years to get it right, and it's still an abysmal failure. You have failed in every government service. You have shoved down our throats while overspending our tax bill, and you want Americans to believe you can be trusted with a government-run healthcare system? Folks, keep this circulating, and then it goes into this whole thing, right? You read this thing, you're like, what an interesting point to be making.
Forward that to me.
I'm going to forward it to you.
Who wrote that?
I have no idea who it is. My dad just sent it to me. I'm like, I'm going to read
maybe
this.
Maybe your dad wrote that.
Well, I mean, we saw the last president was the first business president, really, when you think about it. I mean, most presidents were politicians for a long time. They'd never run a business. I mean, Obama never ran a lemonade stand, nothing. You know, I mean,
not even a lemonade stand.
No, I don't think so.
Got it.
So, you know, I mean, in terms of understanding how things work and understanding how you're going to run something big, if you've never run anything big, and we talked about this on the last podcast, that's why usually it was governors in the past until recently that got elected to president, because the people instinctively knew that governors actually run something.
Yep.
I mean, it's not, they may not be efficient because the states aren't all that accountable either. They can't print money like the feds, but they have to run something. Where you're a senator, what do? I mean, you don't have to do anything. You can just be elected senator and not, you just show up and vote yes or no. You don't have to actually sponsor bills. You don't really do anything. You're running a staff of 3-4 people maybe, and what do? Nothing. I mean, they don't have to do anything. So people know that, and they don't have a track record of having succeeded or achieved anything, and so people tend to want someone who's actually done something and run something and shown they can do it. But a business is a whole different ballgame, as you well know. And so having people that...
So you don't think a senator qualified to be a president is what you're saying?
Not necessarily, no. I don't think so.
Okay. Who's the best president we had that was a senator before? Like before...
Well, the last one we had before recently, before Obama, was Kennedy.
So in Kennedy, you wouldn't say was qualified to be a president?
His family was in business. So, I mean, you know, he maybe a little bit, but it's hard to say. He wasn't president long enough. I mean, he actually showed fairly well in terms of when he was under pressure. He did a pretty decent job.
What do you think about reading this? What do you think when I'm reading this? How do you process it, Adam, yourself?
You know,
By the way, you were a lot more fired up last night. You seem very poised today. You seem like you brought your BET Midnight Love. This is Byron Udell, ladies. What music would you like me? If you would have heard Byron yesterday, we almost got kicked out of the restaurant.
I think we almost got kicked out of the restaurant yesterday.
Yeah, we had a push-up contest.
You guys had a push-up contest.
Hey, by the way, quick shout-out. We did a push-up contest. Impressive.
Respect.
Yes or no?
Yes, I
salute him on the push-up.
60.
Go ahead.
Right around 60.
Maybe
right
60.
Around, give or take, after 60 don't count.
And
he
just crushed.
What do you think about what I just read?
I don't really have any objections to it. I mean, it's hard to object to all the facts right there. And big bloated government, obviously, whether it's Democrats or Republicans, have just been spend, you know, zero.
It's actually not a Democratic thing or a Republican
thing. No, exactly.
Because they've done it on both sides.
Yeah, so
they both overspent.
The question is, do Sam Walton's kids, any of the Walton family, end up hearing this and say, all right, sign us up, bro. We're here to help.
You think they want that life?
No, I don't think they want
scrutiny. They want 40 to 50 billion a pop. What are they going to do being a president?
70 billion a pop.
Yeah.
Not even a little bit.
Historically, when we've tried to goose the business leaders to go into politics, they're like, no, thank you. You know, remember Lee Iacocca?
Yeah.
Back in the day, he comes
Chrysler?
Out, takes on a total mess in Chrysler, turns it around. Or Bob Ben-Moshe at AIG. I mean, talk about an unbelievable turnaround. I mean, just I thought, my God, this was 20% of our business back in the day. And
takes $183 billion out, gives it back with $21 billion 5 years later.
I mean, impressive. I thought they were done. Yeah. I thought they were cooked. Their name was toxic. And then they invited us to Kiowa. They invited us to do a dog and pony show. And
Napa? Is that the Napa?
No,
one?
No. This is
the Chicago
Ritz-Carlton Georgia.
One?
In Georgia.
Oh, okay.
Kiowa.
Yeah.
I thought, you know, they're going to pay for a trip to Kiowa. I'll listen to their crap. But what am I going to hear? Right? He gets on stage. I'm like, my God, they might turn it around. I mean, this guy was magic.
Seriously.
He was.
And by the way, this entire time when he brought him back, he's on his deathbed. Right. He's got cancer.
Yeah.
He's taking shots, and he's got 2 years to live.
Insane.
And that's when they brought him back. And he said, look, I'm living in Croatia, Dubrovnik. I'm by my vineyard. I'm enjoying my life.
Right.
I have my girlfriend. I have all this stuff that's going on with me. I have no desire to do it. They sell him because he was a former CEO of MetLife. He says, I'll come back. He says, but it's a $10 million a year salary. He says, we can't afford to pay that. He says, listen, I'm like a expensive prostitute. I'm very good, but I'm expensive. You want to pay the $10 million? I'll come back. If not, I'm not coming back. They said, we'll pay it to you. He came back. And obviously the rest is history.
Smartest move they ever did. And then Gordon Bethune at Continental Airlines.
Yeah.
I mean, these kind of people... transformational leaders, they're very, very rare, and they don't go into... I mean, politics does not attract our best and finest.
What do you think it is that for someone... I mean, I know we're
going
up.
By the way, is his volume down, or is it his voice that's down? His volume is up?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, so maybe I need to talk.
You got to raise your voice a little, because audience is saying they can't hear you.
Okay.
I know that we're going to obviously get into topics. We have a lot of stuff to cover today, but back to...
this is a special 50th episode.
Exactly.
We got a buddy here.
And it's April Fool's Day. I don't know what we got up our sleeve.
Well,
Byron,
the moment you said it, it's too late. I mean, we can no longer pull a prank
now.
Why would you ever say it's April Fool's Day before Adam, you're a comedian. You know this stuff better than I do.
Okay, well, should I just cancel the mariachi band? What should I do?
Now what do I do on my April Fool's joke?
Jesus! Well, I think people understood that it was April Fool's, but whatever.
Well, the new people that are going to come, they don't know about it. But go ahead, tell us.
Okay, forget about those people. Scratch that for the record. But before we get into things, speaking of Baba Ben Moshe, what is it that would inspire someone who has maybe some, I don't know if he was terminal or whatever the situation was, to say, screw it, I'll come back, pay me what I want, $10 million a year.
What inspires a guy to do that?
When you've already made your millions.
Just the thrill of the chase. It's just some people.
Is it legacy? Yeah. What is it that inspires someone who's already made their money?
They said there's only one guy that can fix it.
Yeah.
That's the recruiting interview. Bob, we think there's only one person that can fix this, and it's you. We need you. Okay, I mean, it's a different recruiting style.
I didn't know of him before. Did you know of him before he went to AIG?
He's a legend at MetLife.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, he was a legend at MetLife. Yeah. He was a legend at MetLife. So people knew of him. Those who worked with him that left MetLife and went everywhere else, they said this guy was not a guy that fooled around. He was a guy that knew products as well as he knew how to run a business. Anyways, shout out to Bob M. Moshe. He wrote a book about his history, what happened with him. When he died, on one end, he was holding the hands of his wife. On the other end, he was holding the hands of his girlfriend. This guy was a very unique character.
Wow.
Yeah, admired leader, very interesting guy.
He was one of those guys, if you were in the room with him, you could feel the greatness. It was like Arnold Palmer or somebody. Some people just have that aura about him.
There's
a halo around him. Jake got a chance to meet him, actually.
Yeah, he's a beast. And,
yeah.
Okay, so let's get into it. We got a lot of stories today. Yes, folks, if you're watching this, if there's any specific topic you want us to cover, go to Twitter, tweet out at hashtag PBD podcast, hashtag PBD podcast. I posed the question already. So if there's anything you want to ask, put it there. We're looking at it. Kai's looking at it because when you put it here, questions, some of these things flow up and then we don't see them. But if you put it on Twitter, we can go look through them and all the questions will be there. Make sure you put the hashtag PBD podcast. If this is your first time being on and you think you're already a subscriber to Valuetainment, this is not Valuetainment, this is PBD Podcast, smash that subscribe button and notification so when we go live, you can join us. And if you just got on, push that thumbs up button to help us out with the algorithms. Let's get right into it. A lot of different topics that we got to cover. Goldman Sachs just announced they are going to be offering Bitcoin second quarter 2021, which is pretty insane to hear Goldman Sachs saying we're going to be offering Bitcoin to our clients Q2 of 2021. H&M under attack in China sticks to stance that angered Beijing. Wells Fargo aiming for employees to return to the office in September. Elon Musk donates tens of millions of dollars to Texas schools and he wants top talent to meet him in Brownsville, Texas, out of all the places, but that's exactly what he wants. Tesla and Toyota are eyeing a restarting a SUV partnership. Volkswagen just hoaxed the hell out of everybody, and we'll cover that, where they came out saying we're going to be Volkswagen. We'll talk about that. It's hilarious what they did.
That is beautiful.
End of a COVID era. Delta to stop blocking middle seats on May 1st. Pending home sales fell over 10% in February as record low supply stifles the housing market. Pfizer officially says that their vaccine is 100% effective. Safe in kids as young as 12. Byron's got some thoughts on that. The new tax plan by Biden that's just insane, and Byron's going to break it down in a way where yesterday, even Adam had a unique moment when it was unpacked. AOC says $2.25 trillion isn't enough. It should be $10 trillion. So even the Dems are going at it a little bit about who should pay taxes, how much taxes should it be, how much the budget should be. Russian hackers stole thousands of emails from U.S. State Department. I mean, what's news? You know, that's been happening for a while, but they did it again. NFL to expand to 17 games. Inappropriate SpongeBob episodes gets pulled by streaming services. We've had a few people that were very heartbroken by that. Matt Gaetz had an issue that happened with him. I don't know if you heard about that with the 17-year-old. And in Trump's interview that was taken out by Laura Trump on Facebook, Facebook just said they took it down. Kai, were you able to find that article and a couple notes on it? Did you print it out or you got it on the website? Okay, we'll cover that as well. Let's go into pending real estate home prices falling 10%. Page number
actually,
four,
actually,
if you want to go to it.
That's actually wrong. It's the pending sales went down because the inventory's down.
Yeah.
Just not, it's,
I'm going to the article.
Okay.
Let me
read
it.
We're going to go right in. By the way, just real quick, Tiger Woods, we talked about that yesterday. Just making a quick little note about that if you want to
Tiger Woods,
talk about that at all. Yeah.
The documentary. Yeah, absolutely. We'll tee up on that as well. Okay, so let's go through. I'll read it to you, Byron, and then do me a favor. Destroy the article if you want to. Do whatever you want to do.
But Byron, do me one favor.
get fired up.
Yeah.
Get all up in the mix. You just did 50 push-ups with Pat. Get fired up.
Come on. So let's go through 60. It. All right. Pending home sales fell over 10% in February as record low supply stifles the housing market. Article by CNBC. Okay. Housing market suffering its lowest supply in history as pending home sales, a measure of signed contracts on existing homes fell a wider than expected 10.6% in February compared to January. There were just 1,030,000 homes for sale at the end of February, a 29.5% drop compared with February 2020. That is the largest annual decline ever and the lowest supply on record. Home priced above $250,000 have seen the most active sales, but home priced above $500,000 to less than a million are starting to see the same low inventory problems. The recent rise in mortgage rates does not appear to be affecting home buyer demand that much. The average rate on a 30-year fixed loan started the year below 3% and is now 3.45%. It is still low historically speaking. Home prices, however, have been climbing quickly. They are up more than 11% from a year ago. Byron, thoughts?
Well, if you read that, the first time I read it yesterday, it sounded like, well, home sales are down and the real estate market's down. It's actually
inventory.
Inventory's down, yeah. Which is driving prices up. And so what happens is when there's tons and tons of buyers, the existing inventory, a normal, natural amount of people come to the market in any given month and they decide it's time to sell their home and they sell their home. We talked a little bit yesterday about new home starts are huge. Lots of new homes being built. The price of lumber got over $1,000 per 1,000 board feet.
What was the number? Average $200. It's over $1,000.
It goes between
$200
The chart is for the last 10 years or so, in recent history, it fluctuates between $200 and $400. It's just a commodity.
So, in other words, bad time to build a house.
Well, it's just an expensive time to build a house.
Yeah.
I mean, it may not be a bad time to build a house. I mean, the materials are only the part of the
price of
building a home. Of course, the contractors as well are charging more because, again, demand is high. So, look, I mean,
that's insane, by the way, if you look at the price of lumber.
That
right
is amazing.
There.
Yeah.
So 2012, say it's $200. Then it goes up 2013 to around $400. Then it goes back down in 2016 to $200. Then it goes up to $600 in 2018, say June.
Briefly, but back down to $300.
Back down to $300. Yeah. And then now it's $1,000 the last 6 months. That's insane.
Yeah, it is. It's
okay,
crazy.
Okay, so bad time to build.
Just
it's
an expensive time for
build.
Materials
Continue.
And labor. That's it. I mean, it just is. It's not that much. You know, everybody knows it. If you try to buy a house, it's more than you thought it was going to be. And if you sell your house, it's worth more than you thought it was.
Say that last point again, please. You said it when you try to build a house.
Build or buy
it's
a house.
More
it's
going to
be more than you thought it might be. And the home that you're about to sell is actually more than – you're going to get more than you thought you would.
It's a seller's
days,
market.
These days. It's a complete
it's
seller's,
a seller's
market.
Seller's right market. Very simple. If it's you not, can sell – let me put it to you this way. A guy says, I put my house on the market. That article that was going viral yesterday. Guy puts a house on the market. Within one day, gets 65 cash offers.
Yeah. I posted that on Instagram.
Yeah, you put that up. He gets 65 cash offers.
Yeah.
My COO puts a house on the market. Within 24 hours, he's got a bunch of cash offers. People aren't. And they ended up overpaying what the value was.
Yeah, sometimes
that
a bidding war can ensue.
The bidding war is going above what the market is. And people are selling today with the following contingent on the contract. Whether the appraisal comes back or not, it's irrelevant. You got to get the house. So, say you buy the house for $1 million. You make the offer $1 million. Mm-hmm. Seller accepts it. Okay, appraisal comes back at $900,000. You still have to buy it at $1 million. That's what's happening.
Appraisals are typically triggered by a mortgage. Yeah.
Sellers can play offense today like never before. Buyers, you're in a sticky situation right now. Adam, what are your thoughts on this?
Well, I've been very outspoken that I'm not a real estate guy. I don't. It all depends on your situation and you're at in life. For instance, I rent and I pump all my money that I make into the stock market. People say, well, you got to have exposure to real estate. And that's why I invest in REITs and I've invested into crypto and I've definitely made some money on Bitcoin and all that fun stuff. I just think that owning a house is one of the more overrated purchases you could ever make. And there's people going to be out there like, what are you talking about? You're an idiot.
Can I say something? I've been trying to tell you I'm going to blow my nose. Can you take the camera off my face? It's like, I don't know what other signals to give you. Go ahead.
All right. Sorry, everybody. So my advice out there, because I always try to break things down, you know, in personal finance for the common person out there. Unless you got a family, unless you got kids, unless you're going to be in the same area for at least 5-10 years minimum, just rent, bro. You know, what I think is the especially right now with the seller's market, what I think the realtor association, whoever did this, the best marketing PR agenda they've ever done ever was when they came out and they said, renting is just throwing money away. Why would you throw money away on rent? And I think it's a brilliant marketing move. But the reality is, owning a home, I think it appreciates at 3% annually. Stock market over time is between 8 and 10%, depending on inflation. So if you're single out there, what's your point? If you're single out there and you're just in your wealth building phase, you're just getting a career and you're just kind of getting things going, it's perfectly okay to rent. Perfectly okay to rent, have a roommate, split, whatever it is.
Do you have a differing opinion to
but
that?
But if you have a family, I can understand if you want to have a good school zone and, you know, people forget taxes, mortgage, maintenance. Like you said, it's more expensive than you thought to build a house.
If you're not going to be in there for a while, certainly you don't want to buy if you're going to be gone in 2 years. I mean, the frictional cost of getting in and getting out and the hassle of having to get out versus just walking away.
People don't know this and they just say, I want to buy a place. Well, have you thought it? No, I think I've got it's time for me to buy. But you have how many houses that you own right now?
Houses?
Properties that you personally own.
Including my office, 5.
Okay. And do you love being a landlord? Do you love owning property? Not really, or is it more annoying than you thought it would be? Give us a little insight to Byron.
Yes, there are always things that you hadn't anticipated. Certainly being a landlord, I have a property that we rent, but I actually pay someone to do that. The other ones I don't. I mean, I am the only tenant in the office building. Yeah. I own the office building, and I own my home. I own my home in Breckenridge, and I have a condo in Snowmass that we don't rent, but I have one that I do. Mm-hmm. And so that's the only one I deal with tenants and It's definitely not a guaranteed win. Mm-hmm. A lot of people think it is. And then there are people that have made a lot of money in real estate, so people think, well, this guy made a lot of money in real estate, so I want to be in real estate. And if I just buy real estate, I'm going to make money automatically, and it's not the case.
Let me just say one thing to that. The people that I know who have made money in real estate, this is what they do. Straight up, this is what they do.
What's that?
They do real estate. They do development. They have general contractors. They've got people that just...
When you do development, it's essentially your product. So you buy something, you sell it for more. So you build buy a piece of land for $100,000. You put up a strip center for $500,000. And then you get it leased up, and then you sell it for $1.2 million. I mean, they're buying something, they're adding value, and then they're selling it for more, or they're letting it run out.
I want to ask you a question, because you wrote an article years ago. Was it in the Denver Post? Am I remembering that correctly?
Post. Good memory.
And you were, I read the Denver Post religiously. Yeah.
It's the 15th biggest print in America.
When I go visit Byron in Breckenridge or in Aspen, I make sure to pick up a copy of the Denver Post. And this particular article that I picked up was written by none other than Patrick Bet-David, talking about when you were in your infancy stages of PHP, you could have bought a house and lived at a multi-million dollar house and done that, or taken all your cash and started your business, which is obviously 100x'd over the last decade, whatever the number is. But give us a little insight into that article, what you wrote and what your mindset was when you were building your company.
For the average person buying a home makes sense. For the average person buying a home, it makes sense.
Highlight average person.
Average person's meaning I'm going to stay in the same city for the next 20 years. I'm going to probably go to a job and do that for the next 20 years. I'm going to make the stable... not moving to another state. You have to realize I have moved 11 times in the last 10 years. Mm-hmm. I have moved 3 states in the last 5 years, 6 years. Mm-hmm. Just 6 years ago, I was living in California.
Yeah.
Then I lived in Texas for 5 years. Now I'm living in Florida. People call me and tell me, how's Texas? I'm like, I don't know. I'm in Florida. I couldn't tell you how Texas is.
And you
right
got
now.
Out just in time.
Yeah, and I got out just in time. But the point I'm trying to make to you is I'm probably not the guy to buy. I'm not a fan of buying homes for me. It's a terrible idea for me to buy homes that I'm living in. Now, at this point, it's a different story. Why? Kids, private schools. Kids got to go to the same private. It's unfair for you to keep changing where you live when you got a 5-year-old, 4-year-old, a 7-year-old, a 9-year-old, and they keep having to make new friends and new friends. You can't create momentum. So you have to make a decision for them as well where it's not like, hey, you're going to move again? Yeah, to you it may not be a big deal, but to a kid, it's too many moving parts. Mm-hmm. Like, let these kids settle down and build some relationships, or else every school they go to, they're kind of like, well, listen, bro, I'm having a good time with you, but we're probably not going to be friends long term. Because the last kid I became best friends with, 16 months later, we left. So I can't get too close to you. Yeah. So it becomes that one thing where you have to be
careful. When you have kids, there's definitely other factors.
It changes.
School districts,
it changes.
All that fun stuff.
For you, why would you buy? Why would Adam buy? No. You're a butterfly. Why would you buy? There's no reason for
beautiful
you to buy.
Beautiful butterfly,
Byron. You're a butterfly. Yeah, have you ever been called a butterfly before? First time I called you a butterfly.
Getting all sorts of compliments. Believe me, I'll get crushed by the end of this episode. But get back to that article where your mindset was at when you were in your early 30s.
My mindset was, I told my wife, we were having a meeting. I'm in front of 66 guys when we started PHP. By the way, shout out to PHP. Last month was a record-breaking month with 11,449 new business partners, and we had 750 by the time everything's done, new licensed agents, which is the third biggest in America today. Most highest newly licensed people with a company will be us in the month of March. There's only two that license more than us in the month of March, which is pretty exciting to see what's going on. Policies will end up being around 12 to 13,000 policies. But I gave a meeting in Northridge, 8550 North Balboa Boulevard. That was the office, okay, in Northridge, down the street from Home Depot. My dad loves going. First thing my dad does when he comes here, he says, "Hey, Pat." I said, "What, Dad? Take me to Home Depot." I said, "I'm not taking you to Home Depot." He says, "Why not?" I said, "If I take you to Home Depot once, I have to take you every time." I said, "I'm going to show you where Home Depot is."
Yeah.
He says, "Okay, okay." So he went. I said, "Why do you want me to go? If you want me to go to Home Depot with you to carry some heavy stuff, I'll go with you." I said, "What are you buying?" He says, "One pipe." I said, "I'm not going to Home Depot for a pipe. Here's the keys."
Your dad is basically Will Ferrell in old school. It's like, I got a nice little Sunday planned. I might go to Home Depot. I don't know.
It's Gabriel the Tank. Yes. Frank the Tank. Gabriel the Tank. Yeah. So anyway,
so you're in Northridge.
I'm in Northridge. I'm running the office. I start the company, and I tell everybody with my wife standing in the back, I said, "Babe, in the next 5 years, I'm not buying a house. Every penny I make, I'm putting it back into the business. We're going to rent." I said this publicly to everybody. Mm-hmm. We lived at a two-bedroom apartment complex at the Summit, and then we went into a three-bedroom house at Encino Boulevard. And then we went to Chatsworth. We had a few homes there. And then we made it out to Dallas. We moved like 5-6 times in California before we moved out. But I put that money into business. Now, that may not be the story for everybody. The thing with buying homes, one story doesn't fit everyone's, you know, narrative.
Right.
It may work for you. It may not work for you. It may work for me. It may not work for Kai. But it depends on where you're at. For me, it ended up working out. But going back to the story here, what's going on with real estate, realtors can be bullies today. Here's what realtors are using, script. You know what realtor script is today? Look, you don't have to make an offer. There's probably going to be five in the next 24 hours. You don't have to make an offer. So the realtor of being the sweet realtor, "I think this is a good investment for you. Mm-hmm. I think you ought to make the move." Realtors today are saying, "Don't make the offer. It's okay. We're going to get five offers in the next 24 hours.
You're saying they could play some hardball.
So all realtors are doing right now, they have one script. You know what the script is? Do you love this home? Because if you love it, make the offer they can own it. If you love it, make the offer. Don't play the game today." Mm-hmm. Realtors have a lot of leverage today if they have any homes to represent.
Well, you've been quite vocal that you are in the market right now looking for a house.
It's wonderful dealing with these realtors, by the way.
What is your experience with all that?
Heaven on earth. I mean, it's just lovely. I wake up in the morning looking forward to dealing with more realtors.
We did have Sonata on the show.
I
got
to tell you, shout out to Sonata. Tim had a birthday last week. We sang for him. I'm a big Tim Sales fan, Elms fan. But, so that's where we are with real estate. We got a lot of stories, so let's get into the next story that we got here. Mm-hmm. We covered pending home sales. Do you want to get right into taxes, or do you want to go into a story before we go into taxes?
I think we should warm up and lubricate the audience before we get right into...
Okay, like, tell me which one of these stories is going to fire you up, Byron. That's what I want to know.
What are you fired up about,
How about
Byron?
We do the Trump story? How about we do the Trump story? Kai, can you pull it up?
The Trump story?
So, no, Trump gets interviewed by Laura Trump, which it looks like it
Look,
was
he's already
at,
fired up.
Which it looks like it was done at Mar-a-Lago, okay, where the interview is being done by his daughter-in-law. Facebook scrubs Donald Trump's interview with Laura Trump, cites indefinite ban, keep going up, for doing this. Can you go higher to see what else they're saying the other way? Go lower. So Facebook took down a video of Donald Trump conducted by daughter-in-law Laura Trump for her show, The Right View. I like that name, The Right View instead of The View. Facebook spokesman Andy Stone said that the video was not permitted on Facebook and Instagram because of the former president's indefinite suspension after the deadly Capitol riot. On Tuesday, Laura Trump posted on Instagram, "Big show tonight. I will be joined by President Donald Trump on The Right View." Laura Trump, who is married to Eric Trump, received an email from Facebook and a content. The voice of former President Trump is not currently allowed on our platform, including new posts with President Trump speaking. Facebook warned that any future posts would be removed, resulting in additional limitations on the account that posted. Laura Trump then posted the video interview on the social network Rumble. Facebook suspended Donald Trump. So what are your thoughts about this?
I think the censorship in the media, especially social media, but all the media, is absolutely anti-First Amendment. It is not America, and it is incredibly dangerous. I mean, nothing they said in that interview is dangerous. I just can't believe we're living in a, this is our country we're living in right now. And it's, and what's amazing is the left was the, they were the ones back in the 60s and all the free speech and for right to assemble, and they were doing all this, you know, peaceful protests and all this other stuff. They were the ones driving, you know, the putting free speech out there as a out in the forefront, and they were the ones, they were the free speech party, if you will. Not that the Republicans or the right was against free speech, but I mean, it is gone today. It is unbelievable. I mean, you can't say anything. If you say the wrong thing, you run the risk of being canceled, and it's crazy. I mean, here's a man that a lot of people want to hear what he has to say. Nothing he said in that interview is dangerous, but because some arbiter of truth, Facebook, Twitter, whatever, decides that whatever he's saying doesn't fit their left-wing narrative, they're going to literally silence somebody? It's insane. Absolutely insane. Can't believe this is going on in America.
You know, it's crazy. Like, you remember the first big name that got banned on social media was who? Alex Jones. It happened within a 24-hour window where he was shut down on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube. They took down InfoWars. They took down all these other things. And then they took down PayPal. And they shut him down, right? But when he gets interviewed, they allow his interviews to stay on. So when Alex Jones goes on Rogan, he did an interview with us on 9/11 like 6 years ago or 4 years ago. He stayed on. It was literally a week after he got banned, we interviewed him. His interview stayed on. They haven't taken it down yet. Why are you taking down an interview of President Trump? Even Bernie Sanders came out. Did you hear what Bernie Sanders said last week about Trump?
Yeah, he thinks it's dangerous because you never know who it's going to be next.
He says, look, I don't like anything about Trump. What he does, he's a xenophobe, he's this, he's a womanizer. Right. He said all this stuff. So don't get me wrong. All of that stuff, I still believe in the guy. But it's, I don't support at all to silence the former president. He says, I don't think that's good for our society. Even a socialist Bernie Sanders defended Trump, and Facebook takes this position. What are your thoughts?
So I'm going to shock you guys, and I'm going to shock our audience.
Here we go.
And I'm actually going to come out and tell you that I agree with our friend Byron. I think it's a very dangerous position where these big tech companies, Facebook, Instagram, you know, Twitter, all this, can just say, no, you're gone. You're canceled. And obviously, they've been looking for any excuse to get rid of Trump for years, even though obviously the media networks' ratings have been sky high over the last 5 years covering Trump and all the nonsense that comes along with the Trump reality presidency.
Oh, they're going to miss him in their pocketbook, I can tell you that.
Yeah, that's true. But, you know, clearly I'm not a fan of Trump, but do I think that the freaking president, ex-president of the United States, should just be permanently banned from being interviewed? No, I think that's a very slippery slope. Obviously, we're talking about the First Amendment here. And I agree with Bernie Sanders, and I agree with Byron here, and I agree with what the First Amendment stands for. And I think, and this will go back to a bigger story. All right, cool, this article got taken down. What are the chances that Trump can either run or win again in 2024? And if this is the narrative, that if any time he comes out and speaks, it gets taken down, put a fork in him right now. Because if you can't get your views out there and your perspectives out there on Twitter, on Facebook, on YouTube, on social media, you got no chance, bro.
Well, you got this
last point, it all comes down to the insurrection or whatever you want to call it, the surge at the Capitol. That was the day that they said, dude, this guy's done. And he's been banned ever since. So
they were just looking for an excuse.
They were looking for an excuse. That's my point. But believe me, he gave him one because that was a disgusting situation that happened.
It was a horrible situation, but it's not what the media made it out to be. It was not 9/11. Let's give me a break.
Yeah, I mean, obviously there were no planes flying into buildings, Byron. I mean, that's a stretch there, but
armed insurrection.
That's true, though.
As far as I know, nobody was found with a gun in the Capitol. Nobody.
The bigger story here is, and we've talked about who are the most powerful people in our country. The president, media companies, social media, universities, billionaires. And who sits at the top of that list these days? I think you'd be very hard to fight against that big tech or social media are the most powerful influencers in the country. I know universities are right up there in the mix there, but
to the extent that they're controlling the content, absolutely.
Completely.
If they just let it happen and let it be. And that's why there's sort of a pent up demand for some sort of decentralization in social media, which is what my son was talking about with that platform.
Shout out to Jake if you're watching. Buddy.
Jake, if you're listening and watching,
so I just agreed.
About you. Who's your biggest fan?
Just to all our, our listeners out there, our fans out there, Valuetainers, I just agreed that Trump should be able to be seen on
social
media.
I think for me, I'm more thinking about, okay, who is behind it? Is Zuck saying taken down? Is Zuck afraid because he's in Silicon Valley and Pelosi is going to destroy his business and regulation, so they have to take it down? Is Zuck trying to be loyal to who? Who's he being loyal to? Who is he afraid of? Is Biden telling him taken down? Are they choosing to take it down themselves? Mm-hmm. Is his board telling him to take it down? Someone's telling him to take it down, because I don't think it's Zuck. I don't really think Zuck is about taking it down. I don't believe that. I think someone behind closed doors is challenging them to take it down. And here's what it does. Okay, mm-hmm. so think about it from this standpoint, okay? Does constantly silencing Trump make him stronger? Or does constantly silencing Trump make him more irrelevant? What does it do?
I think there's a little bit of both, but I think it probably weighs in favor of the latter. I think it makes him more irrelevant because nobody hears it.
More irrelevant.
I mean, when you saw that Biden story that didn't get that was basically quashed right before the election with the scandal with his son.
New York Post, yeah.
I mean, the vast majority of Americans never saw the story. It was a huge story, huge scandal. I mean, anybody else would have been all over the news. And they literally not only shut the story down, they shut down the New York Post. They shut down their entire Twitter account. Are you kidding me? Really? I mean, this is a legitimate...
Well, where's that story now, though? I haven't heard anything about Hunter Biden in months.
Again,
they could still... Fox could still be talking about it, but why are they not talking about it?
That's not how things work. Yeah.
The left... What do you mean? The left is in social media.
They talk about Benghazi for...
The guy just came out with a book talking about his crack experience. He's talking about his experience with crack. Okay. Hunter. So this is not like he got down to a point where he brought a homeless guy to live with him off the street because he couldn't get off the addiction of drugs. I mean, you're not talking about a regular thing here, but he's talking about the silencing the story at that time.
It wasn't just about Hunter either. It was about Joe.
Is it an effective strategy? That's all I'm asking. Is it effective strategy to silence Trump?
It worked. Okay. I mean, surveys have been taken. A vast majority of Biden voters didn't even know about it. So, and if they had, they might not have voted for it.
So 0 to 10, give me a percentage. What percentage chance Trump runs in 2024?
60%.
You're saying 60% he runs?
Yes.
What do you say he runs? 2024.
I'm going to do the Price is Right approach and say 61%.
Oh, you're going to say he's going to run no matter what?
Yeah, I think he's going to run because that eager.
You think he's going to run?
I think he'll flirt with the idea. I just don't know if he'll officially run.
Give us a number.
I'd say I'm going to do like a 50.
Okay.
What do you think?
What about you?
I don't know. I'm below 50. I'm below 50. Hmm. I'm not as optimistic as you guys are. I'm not as optimistic as you guys are. Because the only thing that would change my optimism is if he has a place where people can go every day, every hour to hear what he has to say. If he comes out with a social media...
The rumor is that he will. I mean, shortly.
Buddy, let me put it to you this way. Last night, the amount of traffic that was going on our website, we got contacted by AWS, and they had to help us increase the server to be able to maintain what we were going through the last 24 hours. So, okay, so AWS, you develop a social media website that's massive. Your name is Donald Trump. You're going to need AWS. AWS says no to you. Where are you going to go? Anywhere else you go, they say, if you do business with Trump, you can't do business with us. How the hell did Rumble go down? So if Rumble cannot stay up, you know, Parler cannot stay up, what are they going to do with this guy? Like, what is the difference? So he creates a social media. You need a hosting service. You right. need those he, guys.
He's,
so
he's got the resources to set up his own hosting if he wants to.
He's got the resources to set up his own hosting service. It's not as cheap as you think it is. This is not $1 million cost. It's not a $10 million cost. Hosting service is not cheap, especially if he gets the kind of traffic that we think he's going to be getting. If he gets the kind of traffic that we think he's going to be getting, it's not a cheap investment. So now the flip side of it comes what? If the Republican Party unites behind him to help fund him, different story. Does he have that kind of backing? I don't know if he does. I don't know if he does.
What I will say about Trump, let's circle back to 2014, I think that was the year, and Obama just crushed this guy. Remember at the White House Correspondents' Dinner, and he just clowned Trump like crazy?
Yeah.
And Trump just sat there sort of just stoically and just... And he was... You could just see he was plotting his next
course.
Moves. Plotting.
Of course.
Plotting. And obviously he just was dead set on Obama. What's my point? I think he's now looking at everything going on, and we have not heard the last of Donald J. Trump, whether he ends up becoming the nominee, whether he ends up winning, I doubt that because he doesn't have the momentum and the sneaking up on you, and you know, I alone can fix this vibe that he had back then. But he's plotting, and he's definitely testing the waters. But no doubt, 100%, he will be the elephant of the room whenever the midterms up or the 2024 comes up.
Right now, for the time being, he's in the rear view mirror, and we've got Biden as president. Mm-hmm. We talked about this yesterday. What do you think the Vegas odds are? And if I don't know if you can bet on politics in Vegas, but you can overseas. You can bet on?
Yeah.
What are the odds he serves his entire term, 4 years? Biden.
I told you the number. I said 70%.
But you wouldn't bet me. 50-50.
No, not even money. I bet you 10 to 1. I bet you 100 grand to 10 grand.
But you think there's a 70% chance he's going to serve
out. Yeah, but I'm betting you 10 to 1.
So let's just 10 to 1. If you think there's a 70% chance, then
I'm just betting you 10 to 1.
Well, if you think there's a 70% chance, an even money bet would be a good bet for you then. You're betting he's going to serve. I say he won't serve 4 years.
Then let's do it.
50-50.
I'm not doing 50-50.
It's even money.
I'm not doing 50-50.
You think it's a 50-50 chance?
No, I think it's less than 50. He thinks it's 70.
Was your entire outcome today for me to be held accountable to agree to do a bet with you on this thing? You really think this guy's not going to end his term?
He will not finish his term.
Tell me why. Tell me why.
Health.
I'll bet you on that.
He's cognitively impaired.
Do you not
to
see how he runs up the stairs when he goes on the planes?
He like, kills what it. He's mean? Running the Stairmaster.
Are you
great.
Kidding me? I mean,
what about the video of the other people applauding when he met? Let me tell you why there's a 100% chance that he's going to still be president until 2024. Because the Democratic Party is so invested in him that even if they have to weekend Bernie style him and he's just walking around with sunglasses on, they're going to prop him up
big time. But
that's
my point. They will not be able to prop him up for 4 more years. No chance.
I disagree.
It's just too big a task.
Do you think he's going to go?
Yeah.
Are you willing to do a 50-50 bet?
What's the number?
Whatever.
10 grand.
No, I'm not betting 10 grand on Sleepy Joe, but
do
10 grand right now.
That he's going to still be the president?
I say he will not be the president through the end of his term.
That's actually a good bet if you think he's going to
be. I'll bet you $1,000 right
Let's
now.
Let's go.
Deal.
Oh, my gosh. We got the bet. So
yes. Listen, by the way, if you're listening, for whatever reason, you can't collect my money because I collected a lot of money when Biden won. There's a guy named Ricky Aguilar that still owes me $1,000. So hopefully he shows up and we can work that out. I'm going to keep prodding that guy.
Do it. So, but here's the thing. Here's the thing. Let's qualify.
Yeah.
If he gets impeached, does that count as
impeached?
Not impeached? Hear me out. I'm just qualifying.
If he's not the president.
So whether he's impeached, he resigns, he steps down, whatever happens. If he doesn't finish his term,
that's correct.
You lose $1,000.
He dies. Yeah. He steps down for health reasons. He's not going to get impeached.
Byron, impeachment's
impossible.
Yeah, I don't think it. All right, so we got. So
$1,000 full term.
Yeah, correct. We'll circle back in 4 years.
Why are you so confident about this?
Because I just don't think you can see it. I mean, he looks like a deer in
the headlights. You know what you're doing? And I used to be the same victim. I learned from Pat. You're a victim of your emotions right now. I'm zero emotional. I got zero emotional attachment to this. I'm just gonna make $1,000 and call it a day. Thank you, Sleepy Joe. Good luck getting up the stairs.
Did you watch the press? On the stairs, I don't care. Anybody can fall upstairs. Did you watch the press conference? This guy, when he walks out of the press conference, he doesn't know what state he's in. This guy can't find his car in a 7-Eleven parking lot with 4 spots. I mean, this guy is lost.
You're emotionally invested. You're emotionally invested.
No, I just watch him. He doesn't know where he is. I mean, he loses. He's cognitively going down quickly, and someone's going to step in, or he's going to step down, or they'll make it. They'll do it in a dignified manner. They'll say, look, he's got some health problems, and they'll probably try to make it last past the second year because
midterms.
Well, they want to make it past so that way they can run Kamala twice or three times. I mean, she can serve 2 years, and then
I'll tell you
run,
right now, bro.
She could run.
Kamala
twice.
Harris is not going to be our future president. I'm telling.
I'm just
you.
Saying.
Let me ask you a question. Let me ask you a question. Yeah. I got a crazy question for you. Yeah. Kamala Harris is on the ticket 2024, and Trump's on the right. Who are you voting for?
Damn, who's the third party? Who's the third party?
Forget about it. Third party is Joe Jorgensen.
Let's go, Joe. Let's go, Joe. Half our audience doesn't even know that Joe Jorgensen is actually a female.
They don't know that.
We
asked that question.
But I'm all in on Joe Jorgensen. Right, if the Libertarian Party or the Green Party actually had a charismatic figure and not
we've been saying this for a long time.
No, they often do. They often do.
They often do.
Stop it.
Who?
It's a two-party system.
Bill Weld?
I'm
Joe Jorgensen?
You can't
your
win.
Boy Ralph Nader? Get out of here.
You can't win in those parties. You just have to.
But wait a minute. Who is the most charismatic Libertarian? Who's the most charismatic libertarian independent candidate we've had?
Well, I mean, you look at a guy like Ron Paul.
Said charismatic.
Well, I mean, you know, in his own way. I mean, he's not Donald Trump. He's not a bombastic type of person.
You get some money behind you.
How about Ross Perot?
Yeah.
He's the reason that Bill Clinton was our president.
Yeah.
That was 30 years ago.
It's just very difficult.
Yeah, that was 30 years ago. By the way, I tell you, I don't know why. I actually think there is a big opportunity if the right charismatic guy goes out there. I think there's a big opportunity for a third party.
If The Rock, if Mark Cuban.
Charismatic.
If someone who's like, I got this.
Matthew McConaughey. I'm actually being serious. Matthew McConaughey, if you get somebody like, you're saying no chance?
No chance.
You know, there was another actor.
Reagan?
That ended up becoming a governor, ended up becoming a president. I don't know if you remember the guy. His name was Ronald Reagan.
Yeah.
Do you remember that guy?
I do.
Pretty good guy.
Yeah.
Did you vote for him?
I did.
But you also voted for Jimmy Carter.
I voted for Jimmy Carter in 76. I voted for a third party candidate, naively, in 1980, John Anderson.
And you didn't vote for Reagan in 80?
I didn't. No, I honestly thought about Reagan the way lots of people today think about Trump. I thought, this guy's crazy. This guy's just going to bring us into World War III. He's talking about evil empires and the Soviets. And I thought, oh my God. I mean, because we had just got done with Vietnam.
Inform our audience who is maybe a little bit younger that doesn't remember what Reagan was talking about in 1979, 1980. What was that vibe? What was going on?
He was just talking about, you know, the axis of evil and the Russians and I thought, my God, he's going to usher us into World War III. We're going into nuclear war. And, you know, I was still a young guy. We had just got done with Vietnam. I mean, I didn't want to go to Vietnam. I was too young, and it was over just about the time I would have, matured into the point where I could have been drafted. And, you know, we were scared to death to have to go to Vietnam. And I thought, my God, this guy's crazy. Not only that, he just seemed kind of affable and stupid. But by 1984,
he was the
affable dunce. That's what they thought he was.
Trump back in
1980. Turns out he was way smarter than I thought he was. Way smarter than anybody ever gave him credit for being. And he was ideologically where I was by the time the mid-80s came along. So by 84, he had turned the economy around. I mean, if you remember, I mean, you just go back to pop culture. You can see it on Saturday Night Live. I mean, Jimmy Carter. I mean, this guy, nice guy. I mean, you know, meant well, but completely ineffective. And he got on television. He's talking to people. Look, we have an energy crisis. The world's going to be running out of oil by 1985, and we need to turn down our thermostats and put on a sweater. And everybody's like, I mean, this is what he said. I mean, this is the crazy stuff. And Reagan's like, hell, we're America. We can kick ass. Let's just come in. And I thought, what is this guy crazy? I mean, I'd heard 4 years of Carter. I liked Carter. But I realized by 1980 that Carter wasn't getting it done. I mean, we were being made fools of by the Iranians. They had these hostages. And Reagan came in, and like the day he gets inaugurated,
POWs released.
They let the hostages go because they were not going to mess with Reagan. And, you know, everything he did in 4 years was just amazing. He turned the economy.
Since Reagan, it sounds like you were kind of a little bit lefty, liberal in your 20s. And then
you've heard the saying.
Reagan came in.
Show me a young conservative, I'll show you a man with no heart. Show me an old liberal, I'll show you a man with no brain.
Mm. There it is. So you went from having a heart to having a brain.
Who's a better president, Carter or Biden?
Are
they very similar?
No. Carter was probably better.
Carter better than Biden? Where do you put Biden?
Carter was intelligent.
Where do you put Biden?
Biden is an imbecile. Always been an imbecile. Now he's a senile imbecile. Okay? He's not running anything. They put papers in front of him. They say, sign this. And he signs it. What am I signing? Well, he signs it. And then if he happens to get a little feisty, if they put a paper in front of him, here's your 47th executive order you're signing this. He reads this. What the hell is this? Oh, we're mandating that our daughters are going to have to compete with men in sports. I don't want to sign this. And they said, Joe, sign it. Just sign it. He's like, I'm the president. I'm the freaking president. I'm not doing. They say, Joe, do we have to remind you, Joe, that we have a lot of dirt on you, China and Ukraine and all this stuff? We can throw you under the bus, and you will not be president.
Nobody's saying that to Joe.
Oh, absolutely. Are you kidding me?
Who's saying that, Joe? Listen, sign the damn thing, or we're gonna expose you in the Democratic Party. Nobody's saying that to the president.
Absolutely, he is literally doing what they tell him, and if he doesn't do what they tell him. They will throw him under the bus, and they will gladly put Kamala in charge.
I have a legitimate question for you. Who's they?
I have no idea.
All right.
I mean, it's the powers, the you know, powers that whether it's Susan Wright, I don't know who the hell it is, but
It's QAnon. It's the person.
It's not QAnon, but I'm telling you, there are people that are running Joe Biden. Whoever's running Joe Biden, because he is truly a puppet. Someone's got the strings, and if he doesn't do what they say, they will throw him out.
Because they what do you put him on Goat Mountain, like the greatest of all time president? What do you put him?
Biden?
Yeah.
Yeah. Abraham Lincoln, George Washington.
Like, are you Biden. Of are you in a
he's
place
completely,
where
it's a joke. It's a complete joke of a I mean, I can't believe that there's no way 80 million people voted for this guy. There's just no way. But if they
it's
did
like 85 million.
I cannot imagine that I mean, I get on you watch this guy on television. I mean, he is completely lost.
Byron, do you think that Donald Trump should be on Mount Rushmore? Legitimate question.
I'm not going there.
What do you mean?
I'd put Reagan up there first.
Okay. And you didn't vote for Reagan.
I did the second time.
In 84, I'm saying. In 1980, I'm shocked by that.
All right, let's talk about H&M. So enough with this year. Let's go to H&M. H&M under attack in China. Sticks to stance with angered Beijing. This is a story from Wall Street Journal. The chief executive of H&M, Helena Helmerson, said that the fashion giant wants to be a responsible buyer, standing by a human rights position that angered Beijing and triggered the brand's disappearance from China's internet. Last week, China's leading e-commerce ride-hailing daily deals and map applications removed any reference to H&M after a statement it issued last year about not sourcing material from Xinjiang, major cotton production region in China, suddenly went viral. Alexander Shapiro, head of strategy at Beijing branding agency PBD Creative, said H&M essentially has two choices. It can keep its head down and hope the boycott ends quietly, or it could stick by its human rights stance, risking sales indefinitely. It could also preemptively pull out, a move that could benefit the brand outside China if it is seen as willing to stand up to Beijing. The attention could have been more valued than your Chinese business, he said. Thoughts?
This is China. China decides what the people can see, and China controls 100% of their media. The question is, the bigger question really is, are we becoming China? That's really the bigger question. I mean, this has been going on in China forever. China doesn't like something, you don't see it if you're a Chinese citizen. They control what all their citizens see. This is the nature of being under a dictatorship that they have. The question is that what we have here? I mean, you got a company like they canceled MyPillow. I mean, what the hell is that? I mean, this guy's just got an opinion, and all of a sudden now all these stores are throwing his merchandise. They won't carry his merchandise at Bed Bath & Beyond, and all these stores decide they're not going to carry his stuff because he's a conservative. It's ridiculous, absolutely ridiculous. And I don't really care what happens in China. We know this is not news in China. They do this all the time. The question is, are we becoming China?
Do you actually think we're becoming China?
We're taking steps in that direction, yes.
Because we're banning the MyPillow guy?
It's not just that. Cancel culture is...
By the way, have you ever used a pillow?
I have not.
It's not that good. It's a pillow. Relax.
Adam, yes. We're, forget about canceling the MyPillow guy. Yeah. We're canceling the president's interview with his daughter-in-law.
I already took a stance on that. I don't agree with that.
That's what China does. If China doesn't want something to be heard, they just shut it down. Okay, so... You guys have been in America longer than I have. I've only been here since 1990. You've been here your entire life. You've been here your entire life, minus that one stint when you went out of the country to Addison, Texas. Outside of that, you've been here
the greatest place on earth.
Never seen anything like this.
Okay. That's what I was going to ask. You've never seen anything like this before. What's been the closest to today? Anything? Has anything been
close? I mean,
was Reagan ever silenced? Was Nixon silenced? Like, let's put a Nixon. Could Nixon get on TV, do an interview, and they would show it?
Always. They've never silenced
Nixon. So what's worse, what Nixon did or what Trump did?
Which particular act are you speaking of?
The reputation. The way Nixon's career ended versus the way Trump's career ended as a president, as of right now, okay? The media, the way they sold the story to the public, okay? The way the media sold the story to the public versus what really happened, okay? Here's what Trump did. He is terrible. He's a divisive guy. He's this, he's that. Okay. Nixon, Watergate, you know, control, doesn't let anybody in. He doesn't talk to anybody. He's a hermit. He's this, he's that, he's that.
It's hard to compare those. Those are so different.
Like the point I'm trying to make to you is the following. The point I'm trying to make to you is the following. Which one had more of an argument to say he shouldn't get the platform to speak on TV, Nixon or Trump?
Neither. You can't ever say you don't get the platform. You can't say you can't speak on TV. This is what our country's all over.
That's exactly what I'm saying. It's neither one of them. So the point I'm trying to make to you is right now, today's era that we've had, today, for me, all I know is last 31 years. I don't know nothing past 31 years, okay? You go past 31 years, Could any president get on and just give their speech and give their thoughts, a past president, say, here's what I think about what's going on? Was there any time where anyone was silenced?
No.
Ever?
I can't remember.
Forget about 31 years. We're talking about the last 6 months. So it's not like Trump was silenced in 2020. He was silenced since January of 2021. We're talking 3-4 months at this
point. No, wait a minute. People get silenced beginning October.
He was fact-checked.
Yeah, beginning October. Anything he said...
No, since November, since he lost the election.
No. Fact-checked. He started anything he would post saying, watch them use this against me. From that moment on, they would always fact check him at the bottom saying, hey, this is not... So from October, he started getting pushed around by social media.
By the way, I have no problem with fact checks.
I don't either.
By the way, is there such a thing on social media as... Does any of the social media platforms, Facebook, Twitter, do they employ any conservative fact checkers? Is there a single one? Fact checking the left?
I don't know.
They just get to say whatever the hell they want.
Job qualification situation.
Yeah, you have to be a lefty.
I don't think that's the. I think there are
that's
people.
Who people that,
that
go into it are lefties.
Stop.
I don't think that you. I'm a lefty. I'm coming to work for Google. I don't think that's how it works. I think they're looking for qualified candidates.
Okay, got it. So going back to it, you've never seen nothing like this before. What's
going
on
today?
Listen,
people have boycotted, okay, companies for things they don't like. I remember it was maybe 15, 20 years ago, they were going to play the Masters. And since the Augusta National had no women members, there was a women's group, I can't remember who it was, that headed it up, and they said, we're boycotting, you know, they were marching outside, and what they did was they decided we're going to try to get them to not buy the products from Cadillac or IBM or those. And then what the Masters said was, what Augusta National said was, fine, you don't want to buy, tell you what, we're not going to take any advertising this year, that way you can boycott all you want, mm-hmm. do whatever. And you know, eventually it went away, but to literally cancel someone, say you can't be in our store. I mean, corporations to start pandering to it's just insanity.
Well, speaking of, hi Jen. We have appearance by Jennifer Bette David.
Yeah, I mean, this doesn't happen.
What's going on here?
Why don't you say hello to everybody real quick on
Jen,
camera?
Jen, come on camera,
hello.
Say hi. She's
we're,
six
we're,
months
how many
pregnant.
Weeks do we have left, babe?
Huh?
How many weeks we got left?
So I'm 28 weeks on Saturday.
12. We got. How you feeling? You feeling good?
Bring it.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
She's sitting last night doing homework with the kids. We had to work with Tico yesterday on how to write what he learns. By the way, good story on what I told Tico. She was there. This was a hilarious story.
Yeah.
So I feel uncomfortable. You standing up, babe? But I'll tell the story
get
real
you a
quick.
Seat?
So here's what happened yesterday. It's a funny story.
Yeah.
So Tico has a hard time reading and putting what he read on paper. He doesn't like to do that. He just likes to read. Give him a book. He reads through 2-3 books. You give it to him, he'll be done with it, right? So he's reading this Jackie Kennedy book, and I say, so what did you learn from the book? So he writes, Jackie Kennedy's husband was a former senator. The next sentence is, they lived in such and such. 2 sentences. I'm like, you got to give me more than this. I said, let me ask you a question. Do you ever want to make movies? He says, yeah. I said, you're going to write scripts with movies? He says, of course. I said, when you write scripts about a movie, what Spielberg and what some of these guys would do is it's all about details. You got to give details. He says, give me an example. I said, let me write a script for you. Mm-hmm. He says, what's that? I said, so one day, this boy walks out in the backyard. When he goes in the backyard, he hears a noise and a shadow. It's dark. He can't see anything. He opens the door to go to the backyard. All of a sudden, he hears something. Whew, run to the side. So he looks to the right. He's wondering what it is. As he walks closer to the chair, he sees a splash in the water, sees a shadow under the water moving, looks over there to see what it is. He hears a sound to the right again. I said, that's what you got to do. He says, continue with the story.
Yeah, he says, so what happens?
What was in the water?
I'm like, the point I'm trying to make to you. He said, no, continue. So
was
I'm like, I got to
finish.
So I finish this. I said, so he moves the chair. Cockroach jumps out. So he says, okay, it's nothing crazy. Then he gets closer to the pool. He looks over the water. He sees the shadow moving. Next thing you know, someone behind him pushes him in the pool. Then when he falls in the pool, it's dark. He sees this shadow swim up to him. Guess what it was? What? It was his dad playing a prank on him. Oh, what a great story that I said. Now write it like that. This was yesterday, 2 days ago with Tico. But anyways, thank you for this, babe.
Thank you, Jen.
And FYI, so everybody knows, is this coffee?
No.
What is
Does
that?
Your husband drink coffee?
No.
Okay.
So does your husband need coffee?
No.
Not at all.
That's the real question.
Not at all.
Yeah. Starbucks. It's tea mixed with hot milk and some few pumps of vanilla.
Mixed with a, it's always comes with lipstick on it, just so you know. Mine always comes with lipstick. Every day I get, I'm like, well, I'm nice. She took a sip out of it.
That's so a sexy cup of tea.
I have to taste it to make sure they did it right, so I taste both of them.
You're She's the canary in the coal mine.
Yeah, she is.
Can we give a quick shout out to Jen for a second? I don't know what you're doing with your skin, but like, it's incredible. You're glowing, zero blemishes.
I know. Pregnancy.
Is that what it is? That was my next. I never.
You ought to try it. You ought to get pregnant.
I should get pregnant.
See what happens to you.
I'll see what I can do.
That's what they say. They say it makes you glow. I'm like, well, you know, I'll take it.
Well, your skin looks ridiculous.
Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you, baby. Thank you.
Jen.
Okay, so where were we?
Nice
at?
Little appearance. Well, let me.
Cancel culture.
Okay, we're at camp, but I think we were right at the point where they're canceling H&M and they're banning
H&M. Control. It's completely out of control. And you know
what was the story with Augusta that you were?
They boycotted it, but the bottom line is I don't think this is where the American people are. I don't think the American people like cancel culture. I don't like them canceling comedians, anything. I mean, a guy like Don Rickles could not survive today.
That's true.
Just couldn't do it.
Well, look at our friend Bill Burr. He's somehow making it out there.
Very few. But there's an interesting YouTube video about Bill Burr. We were talking about yesterday how this one guy has analyzed how he does it and how he comes to both sides and he brings people in. And when he realizes that he's stepped in doo-doo, he knows how to get out of it very quickly. Mm-hmm. By either self-deprecation or he does something.
I'm a comedian. It's the best. It's the comedian defense. Pat's looking into that, from what I understand.
I won't mind doing it. You have no idea how much I'm looking forward to doing one day.
Let's
stand
do
up.
It.
I go 5-10 minutes at a local club here. I show an appearance opening. Yeah. And then if I like it, I may do it once a month. Who knows if I like it?
Oh, so you're going to like it.
If I like it, I may do it
because
once a
month. Because
here's
the good thing. Here's what's going to happen. Because you're going to do it, and there's going to be one of two outcomes. You're either going to crush it, clearly, because you're.
Yeah.
Awesome at this, and you're gonna get a taste of it. You're like, I want to do that again, or you're gonna bomb, and you're gonna say, I freaking can't go out like that. I gotta come back.
So regardless,
so what is 100%.
So what are you banking on, though? Bomb or killing it, crushing it?
I think you're gonna crush it, and you're gonna get a feel for, damn, this is funny.
Yeah.
And then here's the comedian.
Add another
defense.
Thing to my list of things to
when,
do.
When you, because I did comedy for many, many years, and then I got into finance, and you know, I opened up a comedy club in South Beach. Shout out to Bodega. Shout out to Ricky's. You can always say, well, I was joking. I'm a comedian. Like, it's a great defense. Guys, don't take me seriously. I'm joking over here.
John Stewart got away
kinda
with
like,
that.
Kinda it's amazing. Like, kind of like Louis C.K.
Exactly.
On that last Saturday Night Live
but
episode.
Last point just about H&M was speaking of boycotting. Can you remember a few years ago they came out with a shirt? They were all up in the news. They had a little black kid, cute little black guy, 10-year-old kid, and the shirt, ironically, was... Coolest monkey in the jungle. Do you remember this ridiculous situation that they had?
You know what I'm laughing at? I'm laughing at the guy saying Adam would cancel PBD on Twitter if it got him an extra 100,000 followers. Joseph Smith.
They're canceled, Joe. Yeah.
Go ahead. Keep on.
So this was a big deal for H&M. I think this happened maybe 2018. Ridiculous is that? Cute little kid, maybe 6 years old. Coolest monkey in the jungle. Are you flipping freaking kidding me? So they had to walk that back, apologize, all that. So ever since then, they've definitely taken a bigger...
Is this a spoof? Or
this is not a spoof. This is real life. This is actually the shirt.
Wait, so this cannot be real.
This is real.
And that was the model they used?
Yes.
Try doing that today.
What year is this? I'm
guessing 2018. I'm guessing.
And nothing happened to them?
Oh, no. Backlash, boycott, all that. So obviously in the last 2 or 3 years, they said, holy shit, we got to... clean up our act a little bit? Is that ridiculous or no? You didn't know about this story?
Well, let me tell you, whoever was the CMO, the marketer, ought to be fired.
Oh, they were.
If you have half a brain, you ought to know that just makes no sense right there.
Ridiculous.
Yeah.
So
what was your outcome
so
of going this route?
What's my point? So obviously H&M had to kind of get woke.
Whoa.
And they had to basically start taking stances on things like China because this whole story started with basically they're speaking up against human rights in China, which obviously I totally agree with Byron. You know, you either play ball with China, you STFU, shut the and get out of the way, lose your funding, get canceled, or potentially disappear like our friend Jack Ma. But the bigger question here with China and H&M is, you ever shopped at H&M?
Never been there.
Oh, maybe once.
My favorite store to shop at. Are you kidding me?
I know it's your favorite store.
That's the best deal in the game. Anyone
store?
Who needs new clothes. And they're like, well, I'm not sure where to go because I'm all about to save that money. H&M is ridiculous. You can go there and spend $300 and have an entire new wardrobe. It's amazing. So shout out to H&M. Just don't get those sweaters with the coolest monkey in the
jungle. What percentage of the population do you think is, if they had to vote, thumbs up or thumbs down on where the country's going in terms of wokeness and being for more wokeness or less wokeness, where do you think the country? You think the country's like, yeah, we got to get more woke, or the country is, most people are like, this is such a bunch of crap?
The majority of people are not in the woke camp, is what I'm assuming.
In the woke camp, or no. Do they agree with it? No, and think they cancel, need to
I
learn.
I think cancel culture is a fad, and it will be phased out, you know, as all this stuff. But don't forget, Byron, when you were 20 years old, you were voting for freaking Jimmy Carter. You were a hippie. You were smoking grass. Whatever you were doing, now you're conservative with money.
I can't
things
see Byron
change.
Smoking weed, but go ahead.
I said grass.
Yeah.
So things change over time. So things will evolve, thoughts will evolve.
What is politically correct changes over time. In the 1960s, what was politically correct was to hate the war, be against the war, mm-hmm. march against the war.
Which
peace,
turned out to be the freaking right.
I understand, peace, love, but our veterans came back and they were treated just, it was embarrassing.
They were
embarrassing.
Spit on, I think it's horrible.
Unbelievable. Horrible. So embarrassing, it almost makes me want to cry. I mean, it is so embarrassing the way we treated our veterans, and that's what was politically correct.
It's messed up.
And it's just, it nowadays, you thank them for their service. Even Vietnam vets, you go back and say, you know, my God, you really, you went. A lot of people didn't go. They went to Canada. They got some sort of bone spur or whatever. Mm-hmm. Everybody's got an excuse.
Yep.
My point is that political correctness changes. There's no immutable truth. And they act like, oh, my God, you can't say that. You can't do that. You do that, you're going to get canceled. And you do. You do get canceled. People worry about being canceled. People worry about mistakes they've made. I don't believe that when people make mistakes, they should not be able to earn a living. I think they should pay the price for their mistakes, and they should be able to earn a living. I don't think you should cancel a comedian. I mean, I don't think you should cancel Louis C.K. for whatever he did. I don't think you should cancel Kevin Spacey for what he did. If he committed a crime, let him pay the price for the crime. But he's a great actor. Mm-hmm. Let him act. I mean, he's good at what he does. I just don't think it's fair to cancel people's ability to support their families and do what they do just to make your point.
The question is, who's making those decisions of being afraid to, you know, sit there and say, yeah, let's go ahead and shut down. Let's go ahead and cancel this thing here because we're going to get so much backlash. That's who the problem is. The problem is who's caving in. That's the problem. The problem isn't complaining. That's been going around for thousands of years.
Right.
The problem is a kid comes complaining to dad and says, you won't realize what the other one did. And, oh, my gosh, what did they do? Are you kidding me? The teacher said this. Let me call the teacher right now. They will never talk to my son like this ever again, like hypothetically, right?
You're right.
So it's the parents that's the fault, not the complainer. I think the complainer is never going to go away.
I think we've been conditioned. We have been conditioned to become offended by just about everything, and it's just annoying as hell. The only thing that offends me, really, truly offends me or upsets me about is when someone gets offended or upset or triggered about something that's not worth getting triggered about. That's what offends me. Like, what do you get over it? Give me a break. I mean, you see all these sports teams changing their names. They're caving to cancel culture, if you will. I mean, the Washington Redskins. I mean, you heard what happened.
Of course.
Finally, after all these years, Dan Snyder, I think his name is. He finally, did you hear his speech when he changed, when he decided he was going to? He said, yeah, you know, after all these years, I've been hearing pressure. Finally, we don't want to offend anybody anymore. So moving forward, starting Monday, the Washington Redskins are now just going to be known as the Redskins.
That was a joke, by the way.
I get it. Okay, all right, let's talk about what Elon Musk just did. Elon Musk donates tens of millions of dollars to Texas schools, and he wants top talent to meet him there. Fox Business story. He's given back to Cameron Country, Texas, home of the aerospace companies, Boca Chica launch site, and a nearby city of Brownsville, which we have an office there. Musk announced on Twitter that he would be donating $20 million to schools in the county, another $10 million to Brownsville for a downtown revitalization. The announcement comes after Musk recently expressed interest in incorporating Boca Chica Village into a city called Starbase. Musk encourages followers in a separate tweet on Tuesday to please consider moving to Starbase or Greater Brownsville, South Padre area in Texas, and encourage friends to do so. He added, SpaceX hiring needs for engineers, technicians, builders, and essential support personnel of all kinds are growing rapidly. Starbase will grow by several thousand people over the next year or two. What do you think about that?
So I think it's just ironic that two of the greatest entrepreneurs in the history of mankind are both living in Boca. Elon Musk is in Boca Chica, and PBD is in Boca Raton, Florida. And we have Byron Udell with us today.
There's a Boca there.
There's a Boca. So, and then obviously a lot of people want me to callate la boca. That's a shout out to Vanessa speaking my Spanish, and Sam, shut your mouth, Saz. What's your point? So my point is this, what a freaking recruiter. Do you know how many people are gonna just randomly just move to, people are moving to Texas regardless, straight up. And now Elon Musk is basically recruiting, saying come to Boca Chica, which is basically on the northeast tip of the Gulf of Mexico where Texas meets Mexico. Sure, it's a lovely area if that's where Elon Musk decided to set up camp. But he is recruiting people. He's recruiting people for high-paying jobs and to live in a nice neighborhood. I think he's going to completely change the landscape of that town. And what a neighbor to have, Elon Musk shooting rockets. And just, I think he's going to.
Hey, what are you doing today?
Yeah.
You're going to say, bam, yeah. What was that all about? I was just shooting a rocket this morning.
I don't like it. Here's 100
grand. Can you tell
us
in the morning next time you're doing it? Yeah, I'll give you a warning.
Yeah. I just think that that Starbase is this new town or whatever it's called in Boca Chica Village is the new place to be. And everyone is moving to Boca.
Can you pull up the picture of Boca Chica Village so the rest of us can see it? Go ahead, Byron. Did you have something to say about this?
Well, listen, Elon Musk is a beast. Everybody knows he's a beast. He can make a difference anywhere and anyhow, anyhow and anywhere and how, however he wants to do it, he can make a difference. The question is this move, this is the move you're talking about, that made it to our news transom here at PBD, is this a philanthropic move or is this just genius marketing?
All the above.
Here's a question.
Is it really philanthropic?
Let me tell you how I process this. I process it in a complete different way. Here's how I process it. Are we going in the direction where people are going to find cities like Boca Chica that no one's ever heard of except for people that live close to Brownsville, and they're going to create their own community and invite people over? Is that what's going to happen next?
Maybe.
Is it going to happen? Are we going in the phase of, hey, if you're a fan of XYZ, I'm creating a community in this area. I'm going to put $50 million into it. Move yourself over here. If you believe in my way of thinking,
yes.
Let's get a few thousand people to live here. I actually love that idea. I love what he's doing.
Love it.
You know what comes to mind?
What's
one of
that?
My favorite movies ever. If you build it, they will come.
They are
Field
coming.
Field of Dreams. And Elon Musk, shout out to Kevin Costner.
Would you buy property around that area, though? I mean, because if people are going to flock there, that could be an investment.
You have to realize a lot of these things could flop. Because Elon Musk, the one thing about him is he changes his mind very often. So one minute he's one thing, another minute he's something. So sometimes he's playing, sometimes he's toying with ideas. But putting $20 million and $10 million, he's probably not toying with it. I guarantee you already the land sales in that area is going crazy.
Oh, and, $20 million, I mean, to him is like a
nothing.
Round. It's not even a rounding
like
error.
$5 to the average human being.
It doesn't mean a thing. I mean, if it gets it on our transom and it gets it on the news and people hear about it, he's going to help him help his cause.
Exactly.
I'm not sure this is a philanthropic move. This is a brilliant marketing move.
I don't think it's philanthropic.
No, it's not philanthropic. No, he's setting up
business. He's putting an incentive to recruit people over there.
I know, but the first line, Elon Musk is giving back to Cameron County, Texas, home of aerospace company. He's going to announce he's been donating $20 million to schools and $10 million for downtown revitalization. It sounds philanthropic.
But I don't take it that way. But I get what you're saying.
I'm just saying. I mean, I'm looking at it for what it is.
There's a part of it that is, I guess, philanthropic, the way you described,
you're right. Yeah. But I think he's just trying to say, come on down. I want some killer talent to be living here.
Yeah, absolutely.
Just do me one favor. You know how much I love Addison. But Boca, I think we're good right now. Let's not go to Boca Chica. Let's stay right here.
No, what'd be funny is all of a sudden we live in like a city 95 miles west of here, where only 200 people live, and we turn that into Valuetainmentville.
Wow.
Okay, and we create a city, and we recruit 5,000 people, then we all live together.
Well, 95 miles west of here, you're talking about Naples, Florida. And it's
was it 95 miles west of here?
Yeah, pretty much.
I don't think it's 95 miles west
of here. How many miles?
I think it's more like 120 miles.
What was Las Vegas 70 years
ago? Excuse me for that extra 30 miles.
That's a big difference.
To
a guy like you, that's an initial $60 Uber for what are you talking? I'm trying to talk about money.
All right, maybe you're right. Yeah. Maybe you're right.
Yes.
Yeah, what was Las Vegas 70 years ago?
70 years ago?
Yeah.
Nothing.
Nothing.
Exactly.
Dirt. That's actually an amazing point by Byron Udell right there. 70 years ago, Vegas was nothing. And look at it now.
And 70 years ago, Detroit
was everything.
Was Motown.
Was the richest city in the country.
In the world.
The Paris of the Midwest.
Yeah, the Paris of the Midwest. And then they screw the whole
thing.
Things
change.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So we'll see what's going to happen there. Next, let's get into taxes. I think it's time we get into taxes.
Oh, love it.
I think it is time we talk about taxes, especially after it was finally introduced, on what's going to happen. And hopefully our buddy Byron is going to give us a course, or maybe give a course to Adam on how taxes works. What page are we on? Page four? Here we go. Okay.
Four, five, and six.
Yep, four, five, and six. We got a lot of reading to do, so just stay with me here. Taxes. 82 unions and liberal groups urge Biden to go bigger on tax hikes and hold the wealthy accountable. Business Insider story. President Joe Biden has unveiled his first part of his first of his multi-trillion dollar infrastructure proposal, which could end up being $3.5 trillion in tax hikes. 82 national organizations led by Americans for Fair Tax Fairness sent a letter to Biden and Vice President Harris commending the administration efforts to raise taxes on the wealthiest Americans and encouraging the president to go further, right? So they're kind of pitching and saying, this is not enough. We got to go higher. So corporate taxes, they're going to lift it from 21% today to 28%.
That's what they're talking about.
Yep. Restored state-level taxes back to 2009 levels, meaning that still only the richest 0.59 of states would get taxed. Return the top tax marginal rate on the highest incomes to 39.6 from 37 today. AOC came back and said 2.25 is nothing. We need way more than that. She pitches a $10 trillion plan.
Well, if it's AOC, I mean, my gosh.
If it's AOC.
She's an expert in everything. She's an expert in climate. She's an expert in all things tax-wise and
economy.
You're
a big fan of her. Oh, you're a big fan of her.
So
I can
smart.
Tell already.
Yeah, she's so smart.
Yeah. Progressive Democrats unveiled the $10 trillion version of the infrastructure and climate legislation. Now, people are asking, what's going to be in this money here, right? The $2.25 trillion. Where is this money going to be going to? He released a sweeping plan to pump money into transportation, renewable energy, manufacturing, efforts to combat climate change funded by undoing, to cover the cost. Biden wants to raise it. We already talked about it. Here's the numbers. Plan provides $620 billion for transportation, $174 billion for electrical vehicles, $180 billion for R&D, research and development, $300 billion to boost American manufacturing, $100 billion for workforce development programs, including training for those who have lost their jobs, as well as apprenticeship initiatives, $100 billion to build a more resilient electric grid, $111 billion for clean water, $100 billion for broadband internet, $213 for housing, $137 for schools and childcare, $400 billion to take care of the elderly and the disabled is what they're saying. And Biden says this is going to boost the economy, is what he feels about it. So before I get to the next article, I'm going to turn it over to you, Byron. What are your thoughts about this thus far?
That's a huge question because you read a lot of stuff. One of the problems that we have is that there are people that can remain in power by creating class envy, and a lot of the tax increases don't really bring in that much money. If you remember back in the 80s, Reagan introduced a gentleman by the name of Art Laffer. Remember Art Laffer?
Of course. He's from Nashville, Tennessee.
The Laffer curve.
Didn't you interview him?
I did.
People don't understand the Laffer curve. To this day, most people, especially young people, they've never heard of Art Laffer. They don't understand
that. They're missing out. The guy's a genius.
They don't understand that if you tax people, let's say, at 100%, okay, you raise the taxes on the rich to 100%, how much money are you going to get from the rich? Nothing. They're not going to work. If you tax them at 0%, you're also going to get nothing. So there is an optimum number where you get maximum revenue. We talked about this yesterday on the capital gains thing. When Obama was debating Hillary in the 2008 election for the nomination to the Democratic to be the Democratic nominee for president, I think it was Charlie Rose or one of the big mainstream guys asked Obama. He said, "Look, Mr. Obama, you said you're on record as supporting an increase in the capital gains tax, but history shows each time the capital gains tax was raised, the government received less money from capital gains taxes, and each time the tax was lowered percentage-wise, the government received more money from capital gains taxes. So knowing that raising the taxes might likely bring in less money for the government, would you still be for raising the capital gains tax?" And Obama's answer was, shockingly, and this is when he completely lost me and a lot of other people, not that I was ever in his corner, but he said, "Yes, I would, for purposes of fairness." And I'm thinking to myself, how stupid can you be? I mean, raising taxes if you're going to bring in less money doesn't make any sense. We have corporate we had corporate taxes before Trump at 35%. Corporations in other parts of the world were down as low as, I think, 9 or 10%. And so what happened is lots of jobs left. Those companies basically domesticated themselves in other parts of the world, and we lost jobs. Obama said, nothing you can do about it. But there was something you could do about it. You could become competitive tax-wise. One could argue that the corporate tax is kind of ridiculous to begin with because it creates double tax on the same dollar. If you own a C corporation, which individuals can own, most individuals don't set up their companies as a C corporation for this reason, but all large companies are C corporations. They're taxed at whatever the number is. Today it's 20%, 21%. What is it?
21
is right now. Yeah. It used to be 35 in 2017. We were the highest in the world. So it's 21. They want to raise it to 28.
To simplify the math, let's just call it 20. You make a dollar, you pay 20 cents in tax, that leaves 80 cents. Now, where does the 80 cents go?
Wait, we're not going to do it that way. Yeah. We're going to do it slow. Pull up Microsoft Word, and here's how we're going to do it. Everybody has to see it. And make the font big. It's very, very important. Can you do Word or we don't have it? Okay, so make it bigger so we can all see the size. Can you increase the size of font? Click that. Can we make it bigger or no? Is there any way we can make that bigger?
Like a 50-point font.
Just write something first and then see if we can make it bigger. It's very, very important for you to see this. By the way, I have the whole transcript between Charlie Rose's conversation. I have the whole thing in front.
I want to read this.
By the way, if you missed what Byron, you just kind of went through it quickly. I think it's very important for the audience to understand what this really means when you're explaining it. And I want you to explain again, show it visually.
Well, but the bottom line to remember before we go in, and then we'll talk about it at the end. The bottom line is that raising tax rates does not necessarily bring in more money. Doesn't necessarily raise revenues. So they say, we got to raise taxes to pay for that. Well, you could raise tax rates, but you may collect less money. Because if you collect more,
100%.
So that's critical.
So go to 50 points. Go to 50 points. Okay, put $1 million there. So say a company does $1.25 million. Just put $1.25 million in profits. $1.25 million. Okay. So that's profits that a corporation, this is a small business. This is not a big business. Okay. The CEO takes $250,000 of salary. So take $250,000 of salary. Just put 250. Just put 250. Yep, 250 out. Which he pays on that 250, say 40% taxes. What's the number on the 250?
100.
So 40% taxes, which is how much?
100.
So put $100,000 below it. Put $100,000 right there. Okay. Which means he nets right below 100, right? Nets 150. Okay. 150. Which, by the way, just put K next to it. Just put K next to it. It's easier. Yeah. So which you net 150. Now, keep this in mind. That's if you live in states that don't have state taxes. So
correct.
We're just kind of putting it for. If you're in California, add another 11% to it, which means you're only keeping 125. But let's just stay with this right here, right? Mm-hmm. So what's left after 250 is taken out? $1 million. So now go below and put $1 million. Put a bit of a space. So it's separating the two. Yeah, go one more. Put $1 million visually to see this. That $1 million right now, you're paying 21% corporate taxes on, which put 21% below is, you know, 210, okay? Now, let's take it to 28, which what they want to do. At 28%, you would pay $280,000, so just write on $280,000. Leaves you with what? 720, okay, net, 720. Now, if the CEO says, you know what, I'm not going to leave the money here because I'm going to end up eventually paying what kind of taxes?
Excess accumulation
taxes. So screw it. Let's just take this money out. If you take that 720 out, how much money you pay on that?
40%.
40% on 720 is what? 288. So 40% on 720 is 288. Put another 288 out. 288 out of 720 is 432. So put 432 at the bottom. 432. This is all if you live in a non-state taxes. This changes if you live in a different state, right? 432 you net on $1 million. How much taxes did you pay? 56.8% in taxes. You're getting double tax. Tax on tax on tax on tax.
Not to mention that when you go spend that money, you're going to pay sales tax and all kinds of
all
property
the other kind
tax
of taxes.
And all the other taxes.
So when people say, you know, let me read this to what you said. I think it's very, very important. It's exactly the transcript from April 17, 2018, okay? Obama sitting down with Charlie Rose, and here's how to Gibson is who it was, not okay. Rose, Gibson. Okay.
Right, okay.
In last night's Democratic presidential debate, this is when they say last night, April 16, 2008.
Actually, so during the debate, he actually said that was the conversation.
Democratic presidential debate between Hillary Clinton, Barack Obama, moderator Charlie Gibson, and Obama had the following exchange, courtesy of ABC News. Video is available. I don't have it with you. I don't want to show because they'll take it down. Gibson, all right. You have, however, said you would favor an increase in capital gains tax. As a matter of fact, you said on CNBC, and I quote, I certainly would not go above what existed under Bill Clinton, which was 28%. It's now 15%. That's almost a doubling if you went to 28%. But actually, Bill Clinton in 1997 signed legislation that dropped the capital gains tax to 20%. Obama says, right. Gibson continues. And George Bush has taken it down to 15%. Obama says, right. Then Gibson says, in each instance, when the rate dropped, revenues from the tax increased. The government took in more money when capital gains was dropped. And in the 1980s, when the tax was increased to 28%, revenues went down. So why raise it all, especially given the fact that 100 million people in the country own stock and would be affected? Obama. Well, Charlie, what I've said is that I would look at raising the capital gains tax for purposes of fairness. We saw an article today which showed that the top 50 hedge fund managers made $29 billion last year. $29 billion for 50 individuals. And part of that was what has happened is that those who are able to work the stock market and amass huge fortunes on capital gains are paying a lower tax rate than the secretaries. That's not fair. And what I want is not an oppressive taxation. I want business to thrive, and I want people to be rewarded for their success. But I also want to make sure that our tax system is fair, that we are able to finance healthcare, et cetera. So it goes into the whole thing, right? But the point is this. History tells us, you raise capital gains, the government doesn't get more revenues.
Well, people can control the timing of gains. So you don't have to pay capital gains tax if you don't have capital gains. Yeah. You can avoid selling stock, sure. And people control
it. You're discouraging me. So, for example, if this is going to pass in 2022, what do you think is going to happen in 2021?
Everyone's going to sell their stocks immediately. That's the point.
And then what do you think people do in 2022, 2023, 2024 until somebody
gets... Just hold on to it.
Just hold on to it. So what happens to commerce?
Well,
I don't know how it affects commerce. I can just say that the bottom line is there should be an argument for effectiveness versus what feels good, and it's about making things sound fair and punishing people for achievement and everything else to make everything equal, to equalize tax rates. Doesn't make any sense. It's all about generating revenue. It's the same thing when you talk about in the military. What you've got now is you've got people running it that think the most important thing is you have to have diversity of skin color. Okay, diversity of thought, diversity of capability, that's one thing, but it's all about effectiveness. If that makes us more effective as a fighting force, that's great. But if it doesn't, let's not do it. It's not about trying to make it look pretty. It's all about making it be effective, and I think the tax system should be effective. We were going to talk about they're talking about estate taxes going up. Estate taxes have never generated any significant revenue. And in fact, even corporate taxes generate less than 10% of the revenue from income or corporate taxes. It's not the main source of revenue. So why would you want to become uncompetitive here, make our tax rate higher relative to other countries of the world, and have companies decide, hey, where are we going to set up shop? We got a new startup. Should we incorporate in Ireland or should we incorporate here in the U.S.? Well, in the U.S., we're going to get punished and tortured with all kinds of regulations and OSHA and unions and all this other stuff. Let's go someplace where they're more friendly to business. I see no reason why we would not want to attract more jobs, but you've got our country was invented by geniuses and it is now run by idiots.
By the way, on top of that, just check this out. Here's the other part. Let's not forget. U.S. companies operating abroad who are paying nothing abroad are currently paying a 10.5% minimum tax to the U.S., right? These are companies that are operating abroad. The Biden plan would raise that from 10.5% to 21%.
Doubling it? Yes.
Which, just so you know, there's a part of that I don't have a problem with because I want the jobs to be more here. But still, 10.5% to 21% is still a big number. On top of all the other proposals, the Biden plan imposes a 15% tax on financial statement income of companies if they don't otherwise pay that much. So this tax thing isn't
That's at the corporate level. And then any of the profits of that company, which go to the shareholders, which are everybody out there, we're all shareholders in something, every dollar that comes to you has already been taxed, and now you're going to be taxed on it again. It's double taxation. I have no idea how that ever was invented, but it was.
Adam.
Well, this is one of those topics, especially when it comes to corporate tax, that you got two ears for a reason. I'm doing a lot of learning. I'm doing a lot of listening, and I appreciate some of your perspective that we shared yesterday on the whiteboard. So I'm learning now. The part that you said that you agreed with, I'm going to make a metaphor here, but is it the part that you said U.S. companies operating abroad were paying nothing abroad, pay a 10.5 minimum tax to the U.S.? Biden would raise that to 10.5 minimum to 21%.
Which is doubling.
Is this kind of like that tourist tax you talked about with Florida
a couple podcasts ago? This is what Trump did. Trump went to people, businesses, who had their money offshore and said what? One time you bring your money, you're going to pay minimal amount to bring your money to U.S., right? One time. And if you bring your plants over here, Trump was trying to bring plants to do business in U.S. Don't forget, Trump was threatening businesses that if you're doing business out of the country, he was planning on making it very difficult for you because he wanted everything to be what? Made in USA, made in America. That's what Trump wanted to do. So I understand where he's going with this part.
America first versus America last.
Sure, and I understand that part. I understand if you're doing a tax to say, bring your money here. Bring your business here.
Do business here. America. Bring your jobs here.
I would give an incentive rather than, taking a route of bring it here and I'm still going to tax you more if you bring it here. Business is going to say, dude, I'm not bringing it to U.S. Because it seems like the more I bring it to U.S., yeah, I'm not going to bring it to U.S. So when they say, I watched the MSNBC. I was watching MSNBC on the reaction to this taxes. And it was like, you know what all these guys do? All the billionaires, all they do is buyback. Everything, like everybody's put into the same box as if everybody does buybacks, as if everybody that's rich is a bad person, as if everybody that makes money has offshore accounts, as if everybody that has a business that's a billionaire pays people $7 an hour. It's as if everybody that has money is a bad person. Like the way they are generalizing with everyone being in a box. You know, there's
a lot
of people
that don't understand
the
math. They're not good at math. They don't understand the math
problem.
That's
why when you explained this yesterday, here's Adam. Adam's not a guy that's sitting on $50,000 in a bank. Adam's got money. Okay, Adam's done well for himself in the last, 15 years. He's made a name for himself. He's one of the best at what he does. He's not just a regular guy. When people think about that specific product that he sells, they know this guy's name. Even Adam was like, I don't think this is fair. So think about it. Even Adam yesterday said, I don't think this is fair. So you got a corporate tax rate, I'm going to pay 28, and then if I take the rest, I'm going to pay 40. You're taxing me at 58, 59%. If you add another 11% taxes, that's 69%. What the hell am I working for?
Well, you understand that in the 1950s, you know what the—
I was literally just going to go here.
I mean, you understand what
it's
the tax
double
rates,
what it is now.
I mean, double.
90%.
90%. 90% on anything over like $200,000, you paid 90%.
Well, your boy Reagan.
Reagan was like, "Look, I'm paying 90%. If I make another movie, plus the California state tax." By the time he was done, he was paying 99% taxes. He says, "Why should I make another movie?"
Well, the famous story with Reagan was that he would only make two movies a year, because he would make $100,000 a movie. And if you made anything over $200,000, you would pay 90-something percent taxes. Right. So he's like, why would I pay?
That's an impediment to commerce. You don't want to punish
achievement.
You don't want to punish a business who's got a printing company, and he says, should I buy another printing press, and should I double my jobs and everything else? Why would I bother doing so if I take all the risk, and if I win, I don't get to keep most of the money? We're already paying over 50% on all the taxes. I mean, at what point? And I ask my lefty friends, like, how much is too much? Mm-hmm. What number is just too much? And if you talk to AOC, she'll say 90%. That's what she says.
Tax rate.
She thinks that
people forget in this country, like, taxes are lower than it's ever been in the history of America.
Stop it, buddy.
In history, top marginal tax rate?
No. Stop that was 28% in 1988.
Okay. I'm saying relatively speaking, whether you're talking 20s and 30s now.
Well,
yeah.
20, 30s
is a percentage. By the way,
understand Kennedy dropped
back
it to
70. Back in the day, it was 90-something percent.
Right. Kennedy dropped it to
70. From 1920 to 1980.
But you act as if it was 90% for like years.
It was.
It was 90% for a long time.
What's a long time?
Decades.
15 years.
90% was top line.
Longer
what income?
Than decades.
What income?
Longer than decades.
Any marginally the nth dollar over 200.
Nth dollar over 200 was at what, 90%?
Yes. Maybe it was 400. It might have been 400.
So how did rich people take their monies out? What did they do?
Well, there was a lot of deductions and things like that. But they played, obviously figured out ways to not
They're
show
going
income.
To. There's no way in the world. I mean, it's not like that strategy is going to work.
Check what I just sent you. We should pull this up.
90% for people above 200 for decades.
Yes.
What year was this and who was president?
Well, it was all through the 50s.
Everything.
All through the 50s and part of the 40s for sure. I mean,
what was the common sense behind this?
I don't think there was
any
common
sense. What was the logic behind it?
Well, the tax code has always been complex.
Here you go. Check this out.
91% go down.
Started in the 50s, okay.
No, not actually 50s. If you go to the 30s. No, 30s. You got 80%. Okay, so yes. You got 81
this
to
is,
94.
This is when the war was going on. So it started in World War II.
So 63, it was at 91%. So you're talking about a 25-year 90% top line. Now, what was top line? Tell me what top line was.
Like the number that you had to make?
I can tell you that in 1980.
Keep going up, see if they showed on the bottom what top line was in. Go put up 1963 top marginal rate income. See if anything comes up. Go ahead. You were saying 1980.
In 1980, I believe it was $400,000, and you paid 70% in 1980 on everything over $400,000.
So people forget. This was my point, Pat. People
plus your state tax.
Right now, whether it's 21% or 28% or 30 or 30, 40% even, people forget that it was as much as 70, 80, 90% for decades in this country. Which I mean, none of us were even freaking alive then, but how does that something like that happen?
I think it's important to understand.
Our friend, Democrat,
go
JFK,
to the Tax Foundation, click on that.
He cut it.
Democrat cut it. John F. Kennedy cut it.
He would not be a Democrat today.
He'd be a moderate. He'd be a
no,
Joe
he would
Manchin
be a Republican.
The tax rate, 1950 to 2000, 1950, top of the 91%, richest taxpayer claimed roughly equivalent amounts of entrepreneur income and claimed equal amounts of wage income and entrepreneur income in terms of business. Passive, okay, got it. Over the next 30 years, as high as tax persisted, percentage of entrepreneur income claimed by the rich dropped from roughly 35% in 1950, 7.8% in 1981. The likely cause was the gulf between the top individual tax rate and corporate tax rate. During the 1950s, the top tax rate on traditional C corporations was 52% and some 39% lower, 39 points lower than top individual tax income. Kennedy's tax cut in 1963 lowered the top rate to 70% right. And the corporate 40%. So very, Kai, go a little bit higher for me to see the bottom right here. Go ahead. Yeah, right there. Keep going. I'm listening to you. Go ahead.
What's
go ahead,
really
Byron.
Important is to understand that no matter what the top tax rate is, and this is a nominal number, okay, it's just there's a number there. The way people behave and what they actually pay doesn't necessarily match this. So in years where it was 90%, if you took a guy who made $10 million, say, how much money did you pay in tax last year? He wasn't paying $9 million in tax if he made $10 million. He had all kinds of deductions. He could deduct his yacht. He could deduct this. And
well, it's marginal tax rates.
I'm just saying there was all kinds of ways. So the effective tax rate is really what you need to look at, not the actual marginal rate. My point is, what makes sense is to structure the tax structure so it brings in the most revenue. That's not necessarily by raising rates. Mm-hmm. There's no static analysis. You have to do dynamic analysis. They make a really, really weak effort to do dynamic analysis when they change tax rates. You got people like AOC, who's an expert at, 2 years ago, she was an expert at making bar drinks as a bartender, and now she's an economist.
Keep going.
It's insane that she thinks she knows, oh, we need to do this, we need to do that. I mean, how could she know any of this? I mean, she's been there 20 minutes. What does she run? I mean, she was making...
You know what I wonder during that time? What I wonder is how many companies were founded during that time. I would love to sit down.
Well, I mean, started...
You know what? You know what? Make a note. Let's bring on Arthur Laffer on.
That would be great.
It's been about 4 years since we had him on.
Would love
Let's
to.
Let's bring Arthur Laffer on. Do you want to join that?
I would
if
love
we bring
to
him
join.
On? So why don't we do and see if we can do a group of four. So it's the four of us with Laffer. Let's get him out here. I don't know if he's traveling or not. He's in Nashville, Tennessee. If not, maybe we'll call him up. Maybe we'll call him up and we'll do a call-in with him, with Arthur Laffer. Yeah,
we went into the 80s in 1980 with a 70% marginal rate plus whatever the California, Minnesota, New York crazy state taxes were. Mm-hmm. Crazy high taxes, horrible economy. We came out of the 80s with a 28% tax rate, okay? And the economy was booming, and it boomed all the way through the 90s. Clinton raised taxes, okay, because he could get away with it. Not raising taxes wasn't what helped the economy in the 1980s and the 1990s. It was the fact that we lowered the taxes and companies just started investing. Say, my God, I get to keep 72 cents of every dollar. I'm gonna put my money back in my companies. I mean, that made a lot
this
of sense.
You have no idea how much this is, Kai. This is the next how-to we're gonna do. We're gonna take a deep dive on taxes, history of taxes. I want every single article ever written on this. I want to read every single article written on this. Period. I don't care if it takes me 50 hours. anything that we pull up, put a stack of articles. Historically, what happened with it? Let's go through every single one. Have our research guys start working on it ASAP.
So, Pat, you didn't know that taxes were
No,
this
I knew
high.
It was 90%. What yeah. I didn't know, I didn't know the timeline. Decades. I thought it was less than a decade. I didn't know it was three decades that this thing went through. I thought it was a decade that it went through because of World War II and, you know, World War, and we're trying to collect money.
The 50s.
Korean War,
I totally
Vietnam
get that.
War.
No, I totally get the part that they had it, but I didn't know what the timeline was. I thought it was less than a decade. Three decades.
That's what's crazy. Through
the what were the results? What were the results of having it that way? I mean, what did it do? Because
well, there's no way to know unless you have two petri dishes of not doing it that way and doing it that way. I mean, unless you have two people, two separate economies that are identical.
What is the incentive, though? What incentivizes somebody to really work their tails off to build something?
Well, you take away a lot of the incentive when the taxes are that high.
But
what they did was they said, look, you don't if you invest.
What was innovation like?
Well, if you invest in this, then you don't have to pay it. So rather than pay it, you say, well, if I make this dollar and I don't do anything, I'm going to pay 90%
tax. I don't believe that 90% is a 90% that you think it is. I think the viewer thinks it's like you make 100 grand, you pay 90,000. No,
if you don't do anything, if you don't do anything,
you got a million and one write-offs that they probably had at the time. So that 91% was probably like a 40% tax.
Well, this is probably what
the effective tax rate was lower again with individuals, even companies. My point is that if you make $1 million and you keep it, you're going to pay $900,000 in tax. On the next $1 million, the nth $1 million. If you take that $1 million and you invest and you buy another printing press, then you can deduct it, so you don't have to pay. So basically, deductions were worth a lot more. Nowadays, oh, it's deductible. What do you mean deductible?
Yeah,
deductible
because,
means I save 30, 40 cents on a dollar. Still costs money. In the old days, if something was deductible, it was almost free.
Go to corporate tax rate, history of corporate tax rate, and then go to history of capital gains tax rate. Go to history of corporate tax rate. Same exact thing you did. Do corporate, and let's do, yeah, go ahead. And pull it up. Oh, yeah, go perfect. So let's take a look at this. Go years. Does it show you years or no? Wow.
I actually looked at this yesterday, and in the 40s, 50s, 60s.
Look at that, 10%, nothing.
What do you mean 10%?
Corporate taxes were 10% in the 30s, 40s.
In the 30s, and then after World War II, the game 50s. Changed, and it went up to as much as 50%.
And then it goes, well, with a high, we've been the highest in the world for a long time. We have the highest corporate tax rate
in
the
world.
And
yet, it doesn't bring in that much money.
Now, go to capital gains, history of capital gains taxes. Capital gains. Go ahead, click on that. Let's see what comes up.
Can I just make a point while you're doing this? This is sort of, look.
Go back and see if you can find a chart.
People are saying, it's a socialism and Biden and Bernie. But people don't understand the history of taxes. It's been way higher than it is today.
How much is too high?
I mean, 1% is too high, but
how much
is
too much? What's a number that above which it's unreasonable?
Well, I mean, what's the state tax in Illinois?
5%.
Okay. What's the state tax in Florida and Texas? I've never paid state tax in my life. I've only lived in Florida. So for me, 1% in state tax is too high. For you, 5% is fine because you'll stay there.
I'm talking about federal income tax.
Okay.
How much is too high?
Whatever your marginal tax bracket is. What are your – I don't know what the number is.
Is 50% too high?
Look, everyone wants to keep their money. But
well, how much is too much?
I don't know.
How much is reasonable?
I don't
how much
know
should the
number.
Rich pay?
Interesting.
I don't know.
70% too high? You're not going to say 70% is too high?
Yes, it is too high.
Is 60% too high?
But that goes back to my point, is everyone wants to harp on taxes these days as if it's just something that just appeared because of socialist Bernie Sanders or because of Obama.
Listen.
This was something that was going on for three to four decades.
I don't know. The only question I got is the following. You know, you see a parent who's like, where'd you go? Who's that? Where are you going? What are you doing? Like overly hovering over the kids. Mm-hmm. Girl turns 18 years old, dates 48 guys within a three-year period. Like, dude, screw you. I'm dating the tattoo guy with, you know, tattoos on his forehead and drinks, ecstasy, partying. You can't say shit, and I'm living with him and I'm moving out with him.
Wow.
Say something, right? Okay.
Wow.
So we don't understand that for two decades, right? The consequence of being an overbearing parent, right? We also don't understand the consequence of taking away incentives for innovation and entrepreneurship.
We started the segment, you talked about Walmart versus idiots or something.
Yeah, morons.
Well, Walmart versus morons. Government screws up just about everything it touches. Okay, it's incredibly ineffective. It's, you know, we hear about the $900 toilet seats and the $700 hammers and all, you know, everything they do is very, very inefficient. We talked about it yesterday. The Department of Education, billions and billions of dollars is spent on the Department of Education. This department did not exist when I was in kindergarten. There was no such thing as a Department of Education at the federal level, and yet we still got educated arguably better. Our test scores were actually better in those days than they are now. So they've accomplished nothing. You get the war on poverty. They've spent trillions of dollars trying to solve the poverty problem, and yet there are more people below the poverty line than there were when they started to try to help people that were in poverty. Listen, the solution is different. The solution is not, hey, we're going to give you stuff and we're going to take from people who have it and give to people that don't have it to try to equalize things and to try to equalize outcomes. The answer is people understanding what the real message is. If you want, we all want to solve the problem. I don't want any children to be hungry. I mean, you know, I'm not, there's no lack of compassion or empathy on my part. I just think the answer is to show them how to, you know, teach a man to fish rather than give him a fish, you know, for a lifetime. You've heard that saying. And so I think it's really important that people get the right message, because nobody cares about you except you. If you think that someone else is going to make your life better, if you put your hope on, if you think that your life is going to get better or your only hope for a better life is something the government's going to do for you, like I heard last week, help is on the way. Help is on the way. We're here from the government and we're here to help. Are you freaking kidding me? Mm-hmm. I mean, really, seriously, if that's what you're hoping that's going to make your life better, you are going to be miserable the rest of your life waiting for government to help you. I mean, it's just not the answer. And so government's just gotten way, way too big, and now they have to figure out a way to fund it. We can't raise enough money in taxes. They can't. If they took 100% of the income of billionaires and the billionaires didn't change their behavior and leave the country and go somewhere else, they just decided to pay it, bend over and just take it, it still wouldn't pay for all the crap they want to pay for. So we just keep printing money, which is going to lead to inflation, and it inevitably has to, because the value of our dollar is going to go to nothing.
This just sort of proves why people are absolutely in love with Ronald Reagan, because the game changed when he showed up in 1980.
But his programs and his policies worked. He was correct.
Well, did trickle-down economics actually work?
Absolutely. Did it? Yes, it did. Did the wealth gap go up? Yes, but the bottom got lifted. So the question is, if you, let's say you're poor and you're making no money, and I could double your income, okay, but I'm going to triple the income of Elon Musk. So I'm going to double your income, but I'm going to triple Elon Musk's income, thereby raising the wealth gap. The income inequality is going to be greater than it was. Would you, you're the person that's making 40 grand and now you can make 80. Would you vote for that, or would you say, no, that's bad because that's going to make Elon Musk even richer?
Well, I'm not a hater. So, I mean, if it's going to increase my income, I'm not going to get mad at the person.
So what's the problem? Is the problem that Elon Musk makes too much, or the problem that the poor make too little?
Yeah, I got to tell you, man, this is a topic I've never been this excited about investing.
Yeah, I can see it. I can see it. You got.
You have no idea how excited I am to take a deep dive into this topic.
I'm excited to learn from
Art Laffer's your guy. We got to get Art in the room.
Well, no. I've had Laffer before. I know. We've looked at him, and I'm the weird guy that enjoys interviewing people and talking about flipping taxes. I actually like talking about taxes and interviewing.
Let's talk
people
about what
a great CPA, but not that you.
Not a CPA. I may have been an economist, but to me, it's a guy the other day introduced me and saying, "Today, my guest is an entrepreneur, a content creator, an author, and an economist." Thank you. And he's an avid card collector. I'm like, an economist. First time in my life I've been called an economist. I'm like, okay. I mean, if I, you know, had
and you did correct him. You're right.
I think
you
the focus should be on driving toward educating the people who make policy toward what actually works. Not what sounds good, not what sounds fair,
like you
what
know,
actually
but
works.
But I tell you one thing here. Like, I agree if a war happens and shit hits the fan, I do agree. We gotta chip into the country.
Fair enough.
I do agree. If something happens,
well,
I'm like,
assuming the war is
like, let
makes
me put
sense.
It, like, let
we
me put
to
it
set
this
up a
way.
War just
like,
to set
think
up a
about,
war.
And let me tell you how I process that. If you're running a company and all of a sudden the company goes through a catastrophic issue that you're facing, say technology, say something happens, but you know you can recover from, you gotta sit there and say, hey guys, you own shares in a company, you own shares in a company, I own shares in a company. Let me tell you what I'm doing. Here's what I'm doing. My salary of $250,000, I'm bringing it to zero for the next 12 months. Okay, I can afford that. I think you can afford that as well. I'm not telling you to do it. All I'm telling you is, why don't we come together? And then you say, honestly, I'll go for 12 months on zero. Great, I am as well. I'm all in because I think we can build this thing together.
FedEx, you know the story of FedEx.
Yes. Then you go to your employees and you say, hey guys, guess what? Here's what we're doing. Next 12 months, I'm showing you my salary. I'm going to zero. And so is Byron, so is Adam. Here's what we're asking from you guys. We are asking you to take a 25% pay cut the next 12 months. Here's why. If you don't take it, we totally understand. We're going to do our best to try to pay you. But we may be cornered to having to let go half of our staff. We don't want to do that. If you stay patiently with us, we're willing to give you some warrants, whatever, to be able to get a long-term thing going, right? I understand if a catastrophic event like that takes place. I fully get it, that we have to kind of chip in and help out. I fully understand it. What happened the last 12 months, does that qualify as that for COVID, where we printed $5 trillion, 40% of all the money ever printed? Does it qualify for us to go into that direction? We keep printing and all this stuff? See, then the challenge for me becomes the following. Here's where I have a problem with Byron, and I need your help as a therapist. Here's what my problem becomes. My problem with it is the following. If we're doing business together, I trust you. I actually really trust you. This is not a script. I trust you as a human being a lot. If you and I were in the business together, you took care of accounting, I'd be like, dude, I know what you're going to be doing. I trust you. I trust this guy in business together, right? He's going to be a guy that's we're going to be all in. And your motive is going to be to help use every penny in the best possible way to help us stay afloat. So 3 years from now, we're going to be big, right? Or we come back and, hey, say, guys, we built a company. We're doing good now. Same with you. I don't trust who's managing the money today of the taxes that we're paying them. I just don't trust
How
them.
How could you? I mean,
that's my problem. Yeah. The problem for me with taxes isn't I don't mind paying it. I went to Boca Meisner the other day, and when you want to have a cup of coffee, you got to pay this, hey, $11.79, your parking spot, and you pay this machine. It takes you 3 minutes to freaking do it. It's really slow. You get the ticket, you go there, and you leave, right? It takes about 3 minutes to do it. I made a video, and I said, here's how taxes ought to be. Pay taxes for things you use. That parking space, I have no problem paying taxes for that because I'm about to use it.
Well, ask the average person. Ask them to look, even just someone who makes 60 grand. Look at what they pay to the federal government.
That's so honest to me.
And you say, okay, well, I know I'm paying. What about school? Well, schools have nothing to do with your federal taxes. What about your fire department? That's not federal taxes. Your police department is not federal taxes. Your federal taxes go for the military. They go for roads and bridges. They're keeping a stable currency. But, I mean, think about what you pay and think about what you get. And the average person looks and says, this is a ripoff. And it's a ripoff because the government doesn't spend money efficiently. They're not good managers of money. The government, I mean, John Stossel did a really nice piece on this public bathroom. Did you ever see it?
Mm-hmm.
He's in his
Stossel's a beast, by the way.
Yeah, he's a beast.
Put him on the list.
No, he'd be great to get him in the room. I'd love to come and have him here. They showed this little small bathroom. It was like a box, made out of bricks. And there was a men's and women's bathroom in this public park, and they were interviewing people. Stossel was interviewing people. What did it cost to build this, do you think? The first guy says, I don't know, $10,000. Obviously didn't know. Somebody says $70,000, $120,000. The guesses were, about what it would be. You know, they figured my house is three times this size, and that costs this much, so maybe a third of that or half that. It costs $2 million to build this bathroom. That's the way government works. It's just the way it is.
Is that where you're going with your point, Pat?
Yeah, kind of. I thought
essentially that bathroom analogy is that.
Yeah, I don't trust where the money's being spent. I remember when we were in the Army, they would show the statements of what it cost, what we paid for a simple bolt. Like, wait, is this seriously how much we're paying for? Is that how much military pays? I said, dude, that's. If I go down the street, I pay 30 cents for that. How much are we paying? $5. Why? Why are we paying $5?
There's no accountability.
There is no accountability.
Well, this is sort of the biggest problem. I mean, I totally agree, but this is also sort of the biggest problem with defense spending is that you were in the military, you get it.
When you have
spending on defense is absurd.
I don't disagree either there. Again, going back to it, I don't trust how that money is being used because there's no accountability to know how they're using that money.
Putting people in charge of decisions where they have no accountability for being wrong is a problem. And that's what you have with politicians. They just find a way to
So let's finish with one topic here that it's not even on the list, but I think we talked about it yesterday, so we may as well bring it up.
You're not going to do gun control, huh?
You want to do gun control?
What do you want to do?
Derek Chauvin or gun control? Which one do you want to do?
Oh, wow.
By the way, did we, in this tax conversation, did we even talk about infrastructure at all?
No.
What do you mean infrastructure?
Meaning we talked a lot about the taxes.
Yeah.
But we didn't talk about
I'm all for
what the point of taxes is.
We did cover where the money is going to be going towards.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, we did.
I don't know if you know this, 80% of Americans are in favor of infrastructure. 80% of Americans. So
they're also in favor of children.
Are you not in favor of improving our airports, our roads, our toilets, our ports, our bridges?
If I know where the money is going to,
I'm not even talking about taxes.
I'm just saying, look, you look at China, they're building railroads and they're high speed rails and
but
everything.
They're doing it with lower taxes than what we're paying. Okay. They're doing it with
This isn't even taxes, this is taking on more debt.
Yeah.
I mean, if anything, I think that look, I don't know if I've ever said this sentence in my life. I actually do agree with AOC here that $2 trillion is not enough for this plan, especially, and that's over 8 years. That's an over a long-term plan, over the long term. But we just fucking printed $1.9 trillion and gave them out stimmy checks to people making $75,000, $150,000.
Hang on a second. Only 10% of that went for that kind of stuff.
Okay, but then more of it went elsewhere. However, that was in 1 year, and we printed out $5 trillion.
Bailing out failing states and all kinds of
stuff. I'm just saying that we did five, let's do 10?
No, I'm saying that was money that was, I'm just saying, infrastructure in this country.
She closed you on doing $10 trillion.
That's not what I'm saying. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying even that's $2 trillion is over 8 years.
We just gave away $2 trillion. We just gave away $900 billion.
And I'm saying I don't agree with...
And we added another $10 trillion?
Hear me out now. Hear me out. I don't agree with this last stimulus package.
Listen, we need to improve our infrastructure.
I do think we do need to improve our infrastructure.
It has to be paid for, though. Where does the money come from?
Okay, but...
We don't have the money.
Apparently debt right here. More debt.
What story you want to go to? I'll leave it up to you to guess. Do you want to do Chauvin or do you want to go to gun control? You choose.
We can go to Chauvin.
Okay, let's go to Chauvin. So Chauvin, here's what happened with Derek Chauvin last page. Let me go to it, page 9. Here we go. Derek Chauvin trial is the biggest courtroom case of the streaming TVH CNN. From a media perspective, the trial of former Minneapolis police officer Derek Chauvin will be the biggest trial of streaming TVH. People will be watching on streaming TV services like Law & Crime, as well as TV networks like HLN.
Yeah, it's on 24/7. It's on the whole
24/7. CNN.com will carry a live stream at all times. ABC will have a wall-to-wall coverage on it. ABC live news streaming platform. CBS will make it available to feed that's Minneapolis station. And the list goes on. Everybody's
reminiscent of
this.
OJ almost.
Exactly.
The last time
this
I
is an opportunity. Obviously, media is going to get a lot of eyeballs and people, you know, traffic's coming to them. So, listen, in a way, their business model, they have the next story to go to. But what do you think is going to happen with them? Guilty? Will he be?
I don't know. I would say that the problem is that the average person saw what the media showed the average
8
person.
8 minutes and 46 seconds.
We saw it clearly looked like excessive force. It looked horrible. It looked like he killed this guy. The question, the people that the average person doesn't necessarily understand the law in Minnesota. And in order to convict him of what they're charging him with, the question is, what do they need to prove beyond a reasonable doubt? And the question is, if they have to prove that he had the intent to kill George Floyd, I think that he has a good chance of getting off, because I don't know that they can prove his intent. And I don't think he planned it. I don't think he, when he was called to this scene, he says, oh, I have a chance. The other thing they haven't proven is any racism. Just because he's white and the other guy's black doesn't mean it's a racist event. It looked racist. I mean, most people were completely appalled by it, as I was when I saw it. Everybody, how could you not be? I think there was universal agreement, which is what I don't understand, is why there were all these protests. Nobody was defending Chauvin initially. But now that they're learning more, the autopsy showed that the choking wasn't necessarily the cause of death. And all you need is one juror. I mean, I'm a lawyer. I understand this. You just need one juror to say, I'm not 100% sure. And if you're not sure, you can't convict, just the way our system works. So I don't know what they have to prove. I don't know. I don't think they went for first-degree murder, which probably would have required, hey, he had the absolute planned it and he intended to kill this guy. Do you think that Derek Chauvin intended to kill George Floyd? I don't know. I mean, that's...
Well, no. When he woke up that morning, I don't think he was like, let me go kill a guy.
Let's just go out and kill somebody, especially if he's the wrong color. I don't think that's the way... I mean, listen, it was the depraved thing.
What did the autopsy say?
I think the autopsy said he had lethal amounts of a combination of two drugs, including fentanyl, in his system. And I believe there was also some evidence that came out that he had some fentanyl in his pocket or his hand when they were going to arrest him, and he put it in his mouth and ate that on top of what he was already high from all of the accounts that the witnesses said when he was in the store, and he apparently passed a counterfeit bill and whatever. It all happened, and it happened very fast. I cannot imagine that he intended to kill him even as he was doing it, because he knew that 15 people are on the sidewalks videoing the guy. He knows if he kills the guy, he's going to ruin his life. Like, why would he do this? He got wrapped up in the moment. I don't think he had the intent to kill. If anything, you know, maybe a negligent homicide. Maybe
manslaughter.
Maybe manslaughter. I don't know what they're charging him with. I haven't looked at the details. Well, I think if they're not careful about it, if they get too aggressive and try to charge him with too much, I think they're going to lose. I think he gets off if they charge him with too much. If they go to the lower charge, they might be able to get him.
Adam.
But I think, you know, politically, this is going to be very dangerous for our country.
And that's where I'm going with this, is for our country. Again, I don't know where this trial is headed, I'm just thinking of optics. We all saw what happened when OJ got off, or when the Rodney King, for the sake of our country and for the sake of our cities and for the sake, again, optics here, I don't give two shits about Derek Chauvin. He better be charged with something. Like this guy, whether he had drugs in his system or not, I don't think George Floyd would have died that day unless Derek Chauvin's knee was not on his neck.
That's actually going to be a matter of fact. They're going to try
to
prove.
We're going to find out, yeah, but yeah.
He either did or he
I'm
didn't.
I'm thinking
I
of America. I charge this mother sucker with something. If you let this guy off, something bad is going to happen.
Do you think he's going to get charged? Do you think he's going to get charged?
I hope so.
Convicted?
Not hope so. Do you think he's going to get convicted?
Yes, I do.
Do you think he's going to get convicted?
I think more likely than not he will, but not necessarily because the facts show he should be convicted of what he's charged with. I think the jurors are going to weigh exactly what you're thinking, Sage. If we let this guy off, we're going to have blood on our hands. There's going to be cities burning. People are going to get shot up.
And you might say,
that's not the way our system works. But again, I'm not defending this guy. This guy is not a good guy.
You think he's going to get off?
I think he is.
You do?
I think he is, and it concerns me. I think he is going to get off.
Why does it concern you? What is the concern?
Why does it concern
me? What's the concern?
Are you kidding me? Like, America's already, the way the media is selling how divided we are, you know what's going to happen if he gets off?
It's a spark.
But I think it's going to get off.
It's going to be ugly.
I think it's going to get off because the autopsy.
Listen, my fear.
I just think about as a lawyer, this is what the autopsy says. What do you want me to say? Yes, you know, $25 million paid to the family, you know, all that stuff that's already been done, et cetera, et cetera. Yes, we're going to get rid of him. Yes, he'll be a limo driver for the rest of his life type of a thing. The same story with the guy that did what he did to O.J. Guess what he is today? He's a limo driver in L.A.
The guy that did what to
O.J.? The cop, with Rodney King. Yeah. The same thing with the cop that did what he did to Rodney King. You can pull up his face. He was on TMZ. He's a limo driver in LAX. Okay, it's embarrassing where the guy's talking and saying, hey, how's it feel knowing what you did, you piece of shit? You're now a limo driver, huh? How do you feel about it? How do you feel? I mean, he's taking somebody's. So, yes, the guy's going to have a miserable life for the rest of his life.
He didn't kill Rodney King. He beat him up.
I can't believe they haven't taken that Chris Rock.
What was his name? I forget his name. What was the officer's name? The name is a pretty, if you go to it, Coon.
No, that's his name?
Go back and put Stacy Coon, limo driver. I think that could be it. Put Stacy Coon, limo driver. Limo driver.
I'm amazed they haven't canceled. They canceled that video that Chris Rock did, How Not to Get Your Ass Kicked.
Yeah, he's a limo driver. There you go. He's a limo driver.
Remember that video, the Chris Rock one, How Not to Get Your Ass Kicked by the Police? Have you seen that?
No, I have not.
When we're done, you should watch it.
I will definitely watch it. So, yeah, I think it's going to be – I think he will be released, and I think – oh my gosh! It's not going to be
pretty. How does he live his? I mean, it's
I'm
just
very
forget
scared.
About him. Yeah. No, forget about him. This is not about him.
No,
this is about
the
America.
Gonna,
what's going to happen?
Flames.
Because what he did, 8 minutes and 46 seconds, and you watch it, it's like, dude, there's, you know, and then you watching the other people that are recording, like even what happened with that lady that got hit up by this guy, who went in, knocked the girl out, the Asian lady. Did you see that with the camera?
Ridiculous.
They kicked her in the face, all this stuff, and then later on they found that the guy stabbed his own wife or his own girlfriend and killed him, and he went to prison for that, and guys are standing on the side not wanting to do anything because they're worried if they get caught, what's going to be said, all this stuff.
Yeah,
I think this is catastrophic. I hope, you know, obviously we have laws that we have to follow, and it's been set up in a way that you have to be innocent until proven guilty, et cetera, et cetera.
And guilt must be proven beyond a reasonable doubt.
Beyond
if there's,
a reasonable
if there's,
doubt.
If there's a reasonable doubt,
I don't
then
think
he gets
they
off.
Have it here, Adam. I don't think they have it here. And I think there's a part
where... depends
what
they're charging him with.
That's a very good point. If that goes that route, brace for impact. It will be a very interesting midterm election. I think this is going to be all they talk about 12 months from now.
And if it takes that long...
how long do you think it's going to take?
It could take... I don't know. It's going pretty quickly so far.
Okay. All right. We'll see.
Yep.
Anyways, hey, if you enjoyed,
thank you.
Byron on. I love having Byron on because Byron's perspective is amazing. Byron's a guy that I love talking to. Him and I connected 10, 11 years ago, and ever since then, it's turned into a friendship. So if you enjoyed it, smash the subscribe button. If you want him back, comment below of what you loved about Byron, because Byron actually will read all the comments tonight at midnight at his hotel room. I'm being serious. He's going to read all of it. So give him a shout out. Let him know what you liked about
it. Torture me if I need
it. And if you want him back, let's get him to comment below about him coming back probably in the next month or two. We'll get him back here as well. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.